Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Danbury Hat Tricks Hockey on the Hat Tricks YouTube channel. Casey Bryant alongside Zach McGinnis, soon to be joined in the broadcast booth by Jack O'Mara, for tonight's coverage of Danbury Hat Tricks Hockey as they take on the Danville Dashers in what is a vitally important matchup for the playoff picture. The Danbury Hat Tricks currently clinging to life atop the Eastern Division, 91 points. The Elmira Enforcers hot on their heels. They've won 8 in a row. They currently have 90 points. So the Hat Tricks, Zach, have to finish this year with a flurry of wins, and they fortunately have a nice little homestand here in the month of March to get that done, but they have a tough playoff opponent against them in the Danville Dashers. What do you expect from the Hat Tricks tonight to try and cement themselves as the top dog in the East?
Well, just as we have been taking a look at the standings, I'm sure the players have as well. They don't like to admit it. Everybody takes a look at their standings. They take a look at the run that Elmira's gone on. They know they need to take care of business tonight, but they're going to be going up one of the best goalies in the league. In my opinion, the rookie of the year.
Jesse Gordichuk is that goalie, and he leads the league in pretty much every category possible for goaltenders. He leads the league with 18 wins. He's got a 2.92 goals against average. And Zach, he got it done earlier this year against the Danbury Hat Tricks. Had himself a .944 save percentage over the course of a pair of wins against the Hat Tricks back on November the 1st and 2nd. How will they be able to solve a goaltender like that and a defense which is one of the stingiest in the FPHL?
One of the stingiest in the FPHL, but what the Danbury Hat Tricks need to do is what they do so well. Get shots on goal. Danbury, they're averaging over 30 shots on goal. If they can get 40 on goal tonight, I think they've got a good chance of walking away with the victory.
They will need some offensive production from guys who fell a little quiet last weekend against the Columbus River Dragons down in Georgia. Johnny Ruiz only had a goal. Nicola Levesque only had an assist. Carter Shinkarik and Shane Morrissey, for the most part, shut down. So how will the Hat Tricks have to adjust here? Billy McCreary has got to be scratching his head a little bit, wondering how one of the most potent offenses, the most potent offense, in fact, got shut down last week.
Well, you mentioned the most potent offense. They have the most goals scored in the league. They have one more than Carolina coming into this evening's games. And yeah, Columbus did a great job of shutting them down. They're getting some reinforcements in the lineup. So a couple new faces. Those are guys who are going to be relied on to keep the puck out of their own end. Let the forwards do their thing. Like you said, potent offense. Danbury has some of the most talented offensive players out in the league. It's going to be up to them to get back to where they need to be.
Well, we're getting set for puck drop here at Danbury Arena. We want to remind you to follow the Danbury Hat Tricks at Danbury Hat Trick on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and YouTube. We're going to turn you around now for live coverage of the Danbury Hat Tricks as they get set to take on the Danville Dashers. Stay with us in a moment. Don't go anywhere. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, for live coverage of the Danbury Hat-Tricks as they take on the Danville Dashers. Casey Bryant alongside Zach McGinnis and Jack O'Mara in the broadcast booth for tonight's matchup as the Danbury Hat-Tricks coming into this game in first place in the Eastern Division. They have with them the Danville Dashers across the way, third in the West, currently trying to make up some ground and win some home ice advantage as they trail the Port Huron Prowlers and try to make up a little bit of ground. Starting lineups first for the visiting Danville Dashers on the forward lines. They will have Patrick Zylak alongside Tyler Quintos and Jesse Neher. On the blue line, they will have Sam Turner alongside Seth Ensor. And in goal, Jesse Gordichuk, the best goalie in the FBHL right now in pretty much every statistical category. Jack, we were mentioning in the pregame show that Jesse leads the league in wins with 18, leads the league in goals against average and save percentage. He's going to be a tough nut to crack here in tonight's matchup, and they will need every line a-clicking tonight for the Hat-Tricks.
Absolutely, and you have to have a better performance, I think, than last week, and obviously a tough trip down in Columbus. You have to come out good energy to start, good intensity, and I think if they go right at Gordichuk, they have a much better chance than letting him get comfortable. I want to see them attack him as much as possible, make him as uncomfortable as possible.
Well, as for the Danbury Hat-Tricks in their starting lineup, they'll be trotting out their top line of Nicola Levesque, Johnny Ruiz, and Phil Bronner. They combined for only 3 points over three games down in Columbus, Georgia, looking for a bit of a better performance here this weekend. They will have with them on the blue line Steve Brown and Kendall Boland Porter, who will be playing on the blue line in lieu of a couple of absences. Vlad Gavrik out with an illness tonight. Martin Tuma recovering from a lower body injury as that one has played out towards Dylan Kelly, the starting netminder for the Danbury Hat-Tricks. Steve Brown comes onto the ice, and there's an errant puck thrown onto the ice, and we will have a whistle as a result. As we'll have to blow play dead for a little youngster who was a bit too eager to throw his chuck-a-puck out onto the ice.
But he chucked the puck, so technically he did his thing, but I think the parents will have a quick talk with him because, early for that.
You have to read the instructions with the product. That's the biggest thing.
That is true. But, hey, credit him because that was a good arm.
Yeah. It was.
That was a good toss.
Try better in my throw. That's why I played hockey.
One-handed up the ice by Mitch Atkins and batted back out into the neutral zone, where chasing after it will be Carter Shinkarik. It will instead be fielded by Ensor, playing it ahead and rifling it wide. A rebound try goes wide off the stick of Atkins. Another try gets weakly gloved down by Dylan Kelly, and he holds. A lively rebound off that end boards, and Dylan Kelly, still a little bit of room on that near side post. If Atkins was able to get a stick on it, that's an early chance for the Dashers.
Well, Kelly came out very aggressively for the shot. The shot went so far wide that Kelly was out of position because it hits off that kick plate. And yeah, you're right, there was room on the short side.
Face-off won by the Dashers and sent right into the rabbit on the center of the sweater of Dylan Kelly, who comes into this game with a 13-5-1 record, a .907 save percentage, and .344 goals against average. Was on the wrong side of a 3-2 game last weekend against the Columbus River Dragons. And for Dylan Kelly, it's been a frustrating stretch here because he's had to balance his ice time with Tom McGuckin, who was recently named the FPHL Goaltender of the Month for the month of February, as Gordy Bunnell fields the puck and slides to Shinkarik. Shinkarik sends one just wide. But for Dylan Kelly, he's in an unnatural position in that he's not really used to having to split the 1-1A. He was the number one option for the Hat-Tricks not long ago, and he's looking to reassert himself as the number one this weekend.
Absolutely. It's a little bit challenging now because both Tom McGuckin and Dylan Kelly have had their kind of time in the spotlight by themselves. Now that both of them are running kind of a 1A, 1B type system, you have to make do with the time you're given on the ice. And right now, it's Dylan Kelly's time to shine. He's had a couple of starts that I think he'd like to improve upon. It's a big game right here at home against a strong Dashers team that you've yet to beat this season. You have to play sharp.
But how lucky are the Danbury Hat-Tricks where you can take the goaltender of the month and have him on the bench for the first of this two-game set?
It's very true. It's not necessarily a bad problem to have, is two goaltenders playing extraordinarily good hockey. Out there for his first shift as a Danbury Hat-Trick, fielding the puck is Zach Sheik, recent graduate from Lebanon Valley College, playing in his first professional hockey game here this evening at Danbury Arena. Sheik looking to earn some ice time towards his playoff push. And Billy McCreary, we spoke with him earlier this week, he's very comfortable with Sheik in that he plays a very simplistic style of play, a very stay-at-home defenseman, as there he is blocking a shot, and that's what you want to see from Sheik, getting into the shooting lanes and doing the little things right.
Well, that was, during the pregame, we talked about guys who are going to take care of things on the defensive side of things. Well, Zach Sheik, 2-3 seasons at Lebanon Valley College. He did not record a goal. He's not going to be counted on to provide the offense. But you know what? You have him back there. You get some guys back. Kendall Bolin-Porter gets to move up. Vlad Gavrik, maybe he gets to move up. Steve Mealy, maybe he gets to move up.
Steve Mealy is playing his natural position of forward here this evening. He normally plays on the blue line for Hattrick's home game. Steve Brown, 3 minutes into this first period so far, no score, and the Hattrick's yet to record a shot on goal on Gordachuk. Bolin-Porter maneuvers to his left and dumps the puck in deep, chasing after it Shinkarik. He'll go in behind the end line. It'll be sent out into the neutral zone where another fellow new Hattrick, Ethan Bush-Anderson, crosses the blue line. Bush-Anderson recently acquired by the Battle Creek Rumblebees. Crossing over the end line, trying to force it towards Gordachuk, and Bush-Anderson making things happen, using his big frame to his advantage, and a nice opening shift here for EBA.
You say big frame, 6'4". He is the new tallest skater, let's say, out on the ice. Marty Tuma, he's listed at 6'4 as well. I'd like to see them go back-to-back, find out who really is the tallest.
And how about a breath of fresh air for Bush-Anderson, too? Come up here to a successful team now, and he's really going to be a star on this team. I think it's going to add some defensive depth for a team that's been hindered at the blue line for quite some time. I think it's a very smart move for Billy McCreary to acquire him.
It's smart, and it didn't cost the Danbury Hattricks much.
Here's Shinkarik with a shot that's blocked in front.
It didn't cost the Hattricks much. You see these other teams loading up like Carolina, like Elmira. Here's Danbury. They make a solid addition without having to take anything away from the lineup already.
Shinkarik looking for Morrissey out at the far side circle. Can't connect. It will be flipped out to the neutral zone where Aaron Atwell will corral. Atwell, the former Danville Dasher, was traded for back at the beginning of the season, exchanged for Christers Bormanis back in early November. And since joining the Hattricks, Atwell has been a revelation and a potential Defender of the Year candidate. As here's Sheik settling it down, sending it over to Anderson on the left wing, plays it towards Gordachuk, steers it aside. Gordachuk aggressively out of his net to paddle the puck over to the near side midboards. Sheik pinches in, sends it towards the net, batted out of the air by a high stick of Shinkarik. He'll have to leave it behind. Efimov Barakov playing it over to the near side circle. Up the left wing, carrying it ahead is Tesserero. Off the back of the net, over to the left wing. Anderson lifting it ahead. Gliding back, and the long hair flowing of number 44, Dominic Minocchio, sends it into the attacking zone. Minocchio looks like he could be a bassist for a heavy metal band with those kind of locks.
I was going to say, he could give the Minnesota high school players a run for their money.
They are going by. It is that time of year.
Flow season.
Puck gets sent down for an icing, and we have a stoppage 5:08 into the first period. Faceoff will come down towards the right of Dylan Kelly. Oh, no, excuse me. They'll change it over to the left side. It'll be knee here in the dot along, countered by Steve Mealy. One by Mealy to the far side corner. Bolin-Porter over to Brown in the near side corner. And Casper Dearson, who returned from a lower body injury last weekend. Out on the ice, quickly goes off to the bench. But Dearson, a goal and 3 assists in 2 games last weekend down in Georgia as this one goes for another icing. Dearson is one of those important players. And again, he was late to the party, joined midway through the season, but he's been such a steady contributor for the Hattricks.
Absolutely. He had that strong weekend where he started with the shootout winner against Carolina, and that entire weekend was a really strong point for Dearson. He had a lot of success. He's playing alongside his former college teammate, Corey Anderson, in this game in particular. But he's been hindered with a couple of injuries that have kept him out for a couple weekends this season, and it just has really hindered him from continuing his role, because we've seen some bits of greatness for Casper Dearson, but it just seems like the injuries are just getting in the way of him really catching fire.
Crossing the way and trying to get around Bolin-Porter, can't connect. Into the near side corner. Chipped out towards the middle. Bolin-Porter doing a good job of keeping his stick in the midsection as this gets sent out to the blue line and sent in deep once more. That one off the stick of Sam Turner. Levesque one-hands it up the boards. Now taking a step in is Atkins, trying to keep the puck alive. A pair of eights in the near side corner as he comes together with Phil Bronner. Bronner is able to get it back to his defender, Brown, but Brown is staple-gunned along the boards. Loose puck out in front. Bouncing puck off the glove of Kelly and off the top of the net. Oh, Kelly barely got a piece of that one.
just enough. And the puck, if it stopped on the top of the net, it would have resulted in a whistle. Instead, it rolls off. It gets sent down the ice for an icing. And now Danville, they get to keep the offensive pressure going.
It's a quick start for them, all over the place. Quick to the puck. Pucks towards the front of the net, making Dylan Kelly work hard. A lot of low shots so far, making Dylan Kelly work with the stick, and the defenders just kind of spinning around trying to catch up. Really, really good start here for Danville.
Bolin Porter has to spin away from a hit from Fred Hine. Out into the neutral zone it goes. Corralling is Danilik. Now Atkins waiting to set up shop here, 6:45. Into the first period, Atkins dancing around Shinkarik, forced wide by Bolin Porter, looking across the way for Hine. It goes off of the heel of his stick and up into the netting, and we get a stoppage of play. Hine comes into this game as the leading scorer for the Danville Dashers. Has himself 28 goals to his name and 26 assists. He is the only Danville Dasher to have reached the 20-goal plateau so far this season. He is going to be a marked man this weekend.
Well, if Danbury wants to get the victories, he needs to be a marked man. And you take a look at the line that was out there. Mitch Atkins dipsy-doodling his way through the neutral zone. Solid hands. His 38 points are second on the team. You got to shut that line down. Simple as that.
Along the midboards doing battle, and Shane Morrissey is able to flip it out towards the neutral zone where Danilik will settle it down, playing it ahead on the right wing. Now off the legs of Ethan Bush Anderson, and Bunnell with a nice pass out to Morrissey. Morrissey looking to get around a defender. He does. Wrist shot, glove save, Gordachuk. Kept in by Bush Anderson. Bush Anderson was upended, gets back to his feet and adjusts his helmet. He gets an early introduction. As he came together there with Efimov Barakov. Here's Atwell lifting it up into the air. Gloved down by Troy Murray. And we will get a stoppage in play as they will deem that offsides, and we will do it from the neutral zone. 7 minutes, 37 seconds gone by. And so far, the neutral zone has been locked down for the most part, guys, and Danville has the third best goals against average as a team in the league. They've averaged just 3.16 goals against, and they're one of the stingiest defenses in the league, and you're seeing why here in the early goings of the first period. Hattrick's having a little bit of trouble getting the puck in deep.
Yeah, there's not a lot of clean passing lanes, not a lot of opportunities for guys to skate with the puck. It's just such a good job right now by the players in white to just clog those lanes up, force Danbury to make pucks go down in deep, and they're quick to the puck, so they're getting there first. They're winning those foot races.
Zylak looking for the setup in front, trying to get it out to Quintos, but couldn't connect. Off the skates of Kasich and picked up by Anderson. He's in with Casper Dearson. Anderson forced to his offside and flips it off of defender's legs. Kasich in deep, trying to spin away from the harassing Troy Murray. Gets it out to Anderson, has his back to the net. Anderson crossing the way to Bolin Porter. Bolin Porter looking towards the net, blocked by Quintos. Bolin Porter back pass to Dearson. Has it at the blue line, looking towards the net, redirected in front by Kasich, but never got to Gordachuk. Here's Bolin Porter, out to Dearson once more at the point. Has a man bearing down on him, elects to send it down low, where it will be fielded by number 44, Dominic Manocchio.
Bit of a newer line there, Dearson, Kasich, Anderson. You can see they still have to work on the chemistry. They got to get their gelling together.
Well, Anderson has been in and out of the lineup, and Dearson has been injured. And Anderson has had to serve 6 games of a suspension over the course of the last 5 weeks. Can't seem to find his way out of the penalty box. That's an unlikely source, really, as Corey Anderson.
He's a nice kid.
He is, and you wouldn't think him to be the most physical presence, per se, on the Danbury Hattricks. He is a strong body, but he's the most penalized player, and by a large margin, due to the fact that he's gotten 3 game misconducts on the year.
Yeah, he's had a couple of hits from behind, and he does like to drop the gloves. He's a guy who will stand up for his teammates, but you're 100% right, guys. I mean, the way you talk to him doesn't seem like he has a bad bone in his body.
Here's Morrissey in with Shinkarik. Morrissey crossing the way. Shinkarik couldn't get a shot off. Oh, Shinkarik had it in his skates, and a terrific back check by Sam Turner.
Yeah, that's an unbelievable play by Turner there. Don't lose your man. Stay on him. It just gets enough of the stick where Shinkarik can't get the clean connection there. I mean, that's an empty net goal waiting to happen between, again, Morrissey and Shinkarik. It just doesn't come to fruition.
Give credit to Morrissey, though. It was that initial move that got Gordachuk out of position.
Bush Anderson looking across the way, intercepted, a shot attempt blocked in front, a rebound try, they score! I believe it was Artem Efimov-Barakov who got a piece of it in front, and a broken play results in a goal for the Danville Dashers. They lead 1-0.
Well, broken play is the right way to put it, because after the failed clearing attempt, everybody in the Danbury zone is just simply looking around, looking for an option, and not picking a man up. The puck, it skitters along the goal line. It's picked up. Barakov is there in front of the net. Not much Dylan Kelly can do when you can pass with such impunity. And the Dashers, they've earned this 1-0 lead.
Well, Dylan Kelly wasn't out of his net by much, and he does take up so much room in that net. He is 6'5". He's got such long reach, but they were just barely able to squeak it by him. Up the ice looking for Neer. Goes off of his midsection and goes in deep. Sheik will give chase. Sheik has Listmeyer out there with him on the defensive pairing. Mealy, Dearson, and Anderson, the forward line for the Hattricks. Kept in now by Troy Murray. Murray has Dearson in front of him, looks across the way. Here come the Dashers. Zylak trying to get in behind the defense, almost was able to split past Sheik and Listmeyer. Listmeyer with a hard check along the end boards. And Listmeyer brings him down to the ice as the two of them are tangled up with their legs in their midsections. It looks like a wonky game of Twister going on behind the end line.
Well, don't sign me up for that one, but Cruz Listmeyer does a great job. He's able to pin the Danville player Zylak up against the boards by taking his knee, putting it between his legs. He has nowhere to go.
Bull and Porter trailing shot, diving block out in front. Now here's Mealy cutting across the end line. His shot from the far side. Bronner got a backhander that was shanked into the padding of Gordychuk, and we have reached the media timeout. What a diving block there. I believe that was Minocchio.
I think it was actually Gullo, Casey.
Oh, Gullo.
He came across, and just that's what you like to see. You're up by one here. You take a huge block in your own end, diving on the ice, and a couple times both teams sacrificing the body to get in front of the shot right now, doing a great job. And not a lot gone to Gordychuk so far. A couple of good shifts for Danbury. I like the way that Bunnell's played so far. Obviously, that connection between Morrissey, Shinkarik, that's been the best chance for them so far. Relatively quiet start offensively for Danbury.
Well, they're having trouble breaking into the zone with possession, because when they're in the zone, they're getting the passes that they want. It's getting into the zone. That's where their problem's been. Danville, I've been impressed by Danville's defense so far, because these are the Danbury Hattricks. They're the highest scoring team in the league. It's a high-flying offense. They can't get off the ground right now.
Well, that's how you get to be the best goaltender in the league, really, with the best numbers, is that you have a solid defense in front of you that makes your job easy. You want as good protection as possible, and Danville doing a good job of locking down the house in front. Faceoff will be to the right of Gordychuk. It will be Ruiz out with Levesque and Bronner. Ruiz wins the dot against Atkins. Chipped down low, looking for Bronner. It rolls past his stick. Ruiz will give chase in the corner, being harassed from behind by Turner. Ruiz has Bronner providing support. Ruiz has it roll off of his stick. Levesque plays it out towards open ice. It's taken away by the Dashers. Gullo is met in the neutral zone, and the Hattricks regain possession. Bronner looking to one-hand it past Turner, but Turner settles it down. Up the left wing, looking for Atkins. Atkins takes a hit from Brown, and the puck will skip past him into the Hattricks' end. Bull and Porter skates away from the oncoming Nick Gullo. Takes a hard check from Atkins. Ooh, Atkins almost knocked him down to his feet. Good job by Bull and Porter to keep his footing.
You got to be steady on your feet, and Bull and Porter not the biggest one out there. But you see how aggressive Danville is. Two players below the goal line on the forecheck.
Man brought down, no whistle. Shinkarik sends a bad angle shot right into the padding of Gordychuk as Zylak was brought down and comes up shrugging. He wants to know how that isn't a trip.
Yeah, he can't believe that. He thought he was taken down, and he might have a case. Shinkarik goes at him with the stick. It's a hard play against the board, so it kind of becomes that borderline call. Do you call it? Do you let it go? And in this case, the Hattricks might get away with one. Shinkarik with a nice shot. You got to use this faceoff now for an opportunity to generate some offensive zone time.
Shinkarik is knocked off the puck by Danilik. Getting support from Neher. Neher forced wide by a couple of Hattricks, kept in at the point. Bush Anderson, long shot off the paddle of the stick of Gordychuk and up into the netting, and we get a stop, 7:29 to go here in the first.
I like the start for Bush Anderson in the offensive zone for Danbury. Got a clear mind, get the puck to the net. He skated well on his first shift. This time gets the puck on his stick and fires it towards the net, creates that deflection out of play. Get the puck to the net, turns your coach's head towards you and say, hey, I'm ready to play here. I'm excited to be here. I want to get involved right away.
Bush Anderson has a chance to get involved in the offense in a way that simply wasn't possible with a team like the Battle Creek Rumblebees. Morrissey turning around, paddle save, rebound try out to Morrissey, shoots it just wide. Rolls out into the left wing, and it'll be carried ahead by Zylak, who pushes it ahead. Dylan Kelly aggressively out of his net, stops the puck, rattles it around the glass. Bunnell leaves it back now for Bush Anderson, who leads the charge up ice. Feeds Atwell, a couple of defenders leading the breakout as Atwell weakly plays it into the corner. Morrissey coming together now with Murray. The two of them collide along the wall. Murray with a nice little stick move to evade Corey Anderson and gets it up the right wing, where it will be played ahead by Levi Armstrong. Taken now by Zylak as a man in the slot if they can find him. Couldn't connect with Tesserero. Now here's Mealy up with Anderson. Mealy off the chin of Anderson and plays it ahead. Anderson looking to the net. Save Gordychuk pouncing on it headlong. As Anderson using his head to get involved in that play. That puck bounced up in front of him and was able to get a shot off.
Well, it stings a little bit, but when you've got the opportunity to get one on goal, yeah, you'll put up with that. But look at how different this line is already. Simply replacing Mattias Kasich with Steve Mealy. Now you're getting speed, now you're getting those zone entries.
It also allows Anderson to get out on the wing, whereas Kasich is a winger, so Anderson has to shift towards the middle.
Giving chase is Brawson. He's got Sheik and Listmeyer. Brawson wins the puck away from Sheik, trying for the stuff-in try on the far side post, but it got sent out in front, rolled off the toe of his stick.
Sheik's got to make sure he keeps his hands down on that.
Kelly will send it out into the neutral zone, and Sheik is still learning the tendencies and just how strong the professional players are compared to Division III Lebanon Valley College, where he was a Dutchman.
And that's the thing, you know, this is as a professional. Now, he played junior hockey with the Connecticut Junior Oilers, so it's possible that he already has worn a face shield, and, you know, not the full bird cage that you get in college. It's quite the adjustment at first.
He is a former member of the USPHL Premier Division. Played hockey here, you are right, Zach, in Connecticut.
He did start in the greatest state of the union. Actually, from that state as well.
A Stockholm, New Jersey native. Not the only Jerseyan on the Hattricks team either.
Now we're starting to collect them.
Ruiz and McGuckin also hailing from the Garden State. Here's Bronner looking towards the net, sends it wide as Ruiz is out there on the ice for the Hattricks. Playing ahead now for Hine. Winds and fires right into the crest on Kelly's sweater, and he holds. Hine so far, that's his second shot on goal, but so far he's been limited to the perimeter so far. He's been letting Atkins and his teammate Zylak do most of the penetrating in the middle of the ice.
And I think Danbury will take that all day. If you have to shoot from beyond that outside circle there, let Dylan Kelly just eat that shot with no rebound, you'll take that all night if you have to. If you can keep him away from those scoring areas in between the circles, in between the dots, and just try to limit him to his offensive opportunities, and the rest of the defense will hopefully follow along and just kind of find a way to go.
Here's Bunnell breaking in. Bunnell on Gordychuk. Backhander stopped by Gordychuk, and he holds. Tried to sneak it through the five hole.
Cheeky. Very, very cheeky, because his stick was still moving even though the puck had already left it. But what a pass by Shane Morrissey just to hit Bunnell as he's crossing the Danville blue line.
And Bunnell's been the smartest player through the neutral zone so far for Danbury. He found a lane right there. Morrissey the head up, tape-to-tape pass, and then Bunnell just couldn't finish. Good save by Gordychuk. Squeeze the wickets.
Bunnell is taking the spot of what was once Casper Dearson's position on the wing, and this will be a slash going against the Danbury Hattricks. Carter Shinkarik got his stick into the midsection of Jesse Neer. And this will go back, played by Steve Brown, and it will be the first power play opportunity of the game for the Danville Dashers. Danville comes into this game with the fourth best power play in the league, 21.5%. As for the Danbury Hattricks, their penalty kill, though it is getting better, it is finally crossing the 80% threshold. It is still just eighth best in the FPHL.
Yeah, this is going to be a big one here, because if Danville finds a way to get things rolling and they can find another goal, that changes the entire kind of flow to this game and feeling to this game. It's already at the point where Danbury needs to take advantage of every offensive opportunity, because they've been limited in that through this first period.
You're right, Jack. It's not. It hasn't been a characteristic start that we're used to here at the Danbury Arena. Moreover, it's Carter Shinkarik in the box. Shinkarik and Morrissey are two of the most dangerous penalty killers out there.
Here's a setup in front as Atkins looking to play it out in front for Quintos. Couldn't connect. Here's Quintos. Back pass now for Atkins once more as Hine out there with him on the forward lines. Set up to the slot, and that shot goes just wide off the stick of Brawson. Brawson and Turner complete the five-man power play unit for the Dashers. Turner for Atkins along the wall as Brown in front of him. Hine is setting up in between the hash marks. They get it out to Brawson as Bunnell in front of him. Brawson now to Turner. 1:05 to go in the power play. Quintos at the blue line. Crosses to the far side point. Ruiz in front of him. Wires it down low for Brawson. Atkins also behind the end line as well as Hine. Bolin Porter gets a stick on it, knocking it along the kick plate. Bolin Porter ties him up along the wall. 50 seconds to go in the power play. 3:20 to go in the period. Bolin Porter still jostling for the puck. Bolin Porter with a terrific job limiting them to the outside. Now out once more to Atkins. To the high slot, Turner. To Quintos. Down low, Atkins dancing around Bolin Porter, and we get a stoppage of play as, what do we have here? As it looks like we get a stoppage. Is the net off? I believe the near side post is barely off its mooring.
It was a couple millimeters there, and luckily Danbury will be able to change, because if those guys kept, if they were kept out there, they've already been out there for a minute 24, and they've spent a lot of that time running around their own end.
And you see how much tighter all the guys in black jerseys got. They got tighter and tighter towards the goaltender, and Danville was just passing with pleasure on that sequence, moving the puck ever so gracefully to the top, to the bottom. They just didn't get any good shots, and luckily the puck or the post comes off its mooring.
Neher looking to send it down low. It finds the stick of Aaron Antwell instead. Here's Tesserera. Tesserera, Neher, and Efimov Barakov are the three forwards out there for the Danville Dashers. Carrying it ahead is Ensor. He's met by a couple of hat-trick stick. Picking it off is Efimov Barakov to Neher. Long slap shot from the high slot, gloved down by Dylan Kelly. 2 seconds remains in the penalty to Carter Shinkarik, so the Dashers will get one more offensive zone draw with the man advantage.
Let's see if Danville's defense, and let's see where they line up. Yes, it's an offensive zone faceoff. Only 2 seconds left on that penalty, though. Carter Shinkarik by himself in the neutral zone. Danbury's got to be looking that way.
It will be Tesserero in the faceoff dot against Corey Anderson. Anderson, Dearson, Atwell, and Bush Anderson will be the four-man penalty kill unit. Shinkarik is out of the box, and we're back to 5-on-5.
Well, good job there by Seth Ensor. He backs out of the zone before the puck does, stops that pass from ever getting through to Shinkarik.
Now here's Anderson with a head of steam. Anderson can develop a 2-on-1. Anderson to the net. He scores! Corey Anderson with a snipe. We're tied at 1.
Take cover. My goodness, what a shot by Corey Anderson. That might have gone off both the crossbar and the post. There was no room there, and somehow he tickles the twine behind Jesse Gorderchuk and gets Danbury on the board.
And it's a moment where there's no neutral zone play for Danville. There's so much space, and Anderson, he's not the fastest guy in the world, but he's got a burst of speed here and the ability for him to push that puck ahead and then come together, corral it, and rip that shot. He had the passing option. He says, no, I'm just going to take my shot, and beats Gorderchuk cleanly. Really, really beautiful goal there for Corey Anderson.
And give credit to Casper Dearson, because he sees Corey Anderson put his head down and just jet ahead. Dearson does the same thing. He has to stay valid as a threat so that Gorderchuk doesn't just line up with the shooter. Instead, he has to respect that pass that opens things up on the near side for Anderson.
And they mentioned at the beginning of the game, before they took the ice, they're back on the line together. They were happy about it. They're back. Both of them are healthy, returning from suspensions. And that Manhattanville chemistry creates that little space. Anderson has that room to shoot.
Anderson with the head fake there. He could have passed it over to Dearson. I think Gorderchuk was anticipating that pass, but Anderson unloads a lethal wrist shot and barreling in like a bowling ball coming down on Gorderchuk, just headlong into the zone. And for Corey Anderson, he now has 9 points in 9 of his last 11 games. That is his 23rd of the season. He's got 7 goals in his last 11 games. And Well, they don't call him Scory for nothing in this town.
And how about the response, too? You're down 1-0, not a lot of energy. You kill off a nice power play there, and then you go right back through the neutral zone. You kind of catch Danville napping, and you just use that speed. And Corey Anderson, just he's been fantastic all season long. He continues to have one of the best shots on this team.
Here's Shinkarik now trying to get around a defender. Shinkarik has Gordachuk out of position, trying to stuff it in on the near side post. And Gordachuk holds his pad on the ice.
Oh, he needed to, because that took a weird bounce off of the Danville bench. Shinkarik picks it up. He manages to deke Gordachuk down to the ice and then tries coming back along that near side. Little bank play, get it on in.
Yeah, Danville's got to really tighten up now, especially at their own blue line, because if Danbury could start to sneak those passes in, the stretch passes have started to work over the last couple of minutes. If that keeps happening, they're going to be exposed at the back. Have to tighten that up.
Well, they had to go to the stretch pass. The neutral zone, nothing was happening for him. You send somebody up high, that forces the defenders to retreat. It makes that space open up.
Atkins trying to spin away from Atwell. Atkins has it out in open space. It goes off of his backhand. Now picking it up with a head of steam is Levesque. A 3-on-2 if they hurry. Levesque has push Anderson and Bronner. Levesque, backhander saved by Gordachuk. 1:15 to go in the first period. We're tied at one. Carrying it in is Atkins. Gets past Ruiz. Atkins, backhander. He scores! Mitch Atkins with a beauty of a backhander, and the Dashers regain the lead. It's 2-1.
Well, there you go with that line again. They jump on a nice little break, and Atkins, who's had a very, very strong first period here, he gets the response that Danville needs. And that's a great way to silence the crowd. Atkins all over the blue paint here, crashes right into the net and gets a good one on Dylan Kelly. Just like that, Danville's got control of the game again.
Well, I tell you what, Atkins with a terrific job of recognizing the mismatch there. It's like a guard knowing he's got a forward in front of him. He recognizes that Ruiz is back in the defensive zone, a forward by trade. He gets him spinning like a topping in the defensive zone and burns him for a backhander. And backhanders have been really the thorn in Dylan Kelly's side these last couple of weeks. As we hit the final minute of play here in the first period, the Dashers answer back and get a 2-1 lead. I will say, going back to that goal for the Danbury Hattricks, though, gentlemen, is that Ethan Bush Anderson was credited with the primary assist. That is his first point as a Danbury Hattrick and his first point in the last 17 games. He had not scored since January 17th.
Nice coming to Danbury like that.
So I'm sure that he is wiping his brow and he's happy to finally find his way onto the stat sheet. Nevertheless, he and his squad will have to come from behind in this one. Out to the far side point, Kendall Boland-Porter chips it ahead. Sticked down by Murray. Murray trying to pitchfork it up. It instead goes out of play up into the 200 section, overhanging the far side of the ice.
And they said it touched the glass first, so there's no delay.
Faceoff will remain to the right of Gordachuk, and we'll get a line change for the Hattricks as Morrissey, Shinkarik, and Bunnell will make their way onto the ice, replacing Mealy, Anderson, and Dearson. It will be Neher in the faceoff dot, countered by Shinkarik. Shinkarik gets it back intended for Morrissey and instead finds its way to Boland-Porter. Long wrist shot seen all the way and held by Gordachuk, 40.5 remaining in the first. Shinkarik and Neher once more do battle to the right of Gordachuk. Tied up, finds its way out to Brown. Brown has a body in front of him, elects to go around the perimeter. Shinkarik looking for Morrissey. Morrissey on the near side post, quickly covered up by Gordachuk. Active glove hand there, getting it down on the ice.
And Morrissey just mishandled that puck. He had actually a little bit of space there, so if he's able to pull that on, he can either move that across or try to stuff it into the near side post. He just didn't get anything on it. It's easy for Gordachuk to stick his hand out, cover that puck.
This time the faceoff will be to the left of Gordachuk. Same foes in the faceoff dot, though. It's won by Shinkarik. Morrissey's long shot saved by Gordachuk. Rebound is alive. Here's Atkins. 20 seconds remaining in the first period. Morrissey cycling it to Bunnell. Bunnell looking for the setup in front. Shinkarik is planting himself in the blue paint. Gets it to Brown at the point. Crossing to Boland-Porter. 15 seconds to go. Boland-Porter to Morrissey. Redirects it towards the net. Kept alive Bunnell. Out to Brown once more at the blue line. Brown, long shot through traffic. Redirected just wide. 5 seconds to go in the period. It will be knocked out into the neutral zone by Gullo. And that will do it for the opening frame. 2-1 is your score at the end of 20 minutes. The Danbury Hattricks will finish the period with the shots on goal advantage thanks to a late flurry, but really it was the Danville Dashers that imposed their will in the neutral zone, and that's why they have themselves a lead here in the first period.
Absolutely. They took Danbury out of the game early, and despite their late surge, that first goal, I think, really sets the table because now Danbury trails. They're trying to chase. Anderson gets a great shot, and then Danville's able to answer right back. Mitch Atkins, who's been all over the ice having a great game, he finds one. He exposes the Danbury defense, and right now Danville's very happy with where they stand in this game. They're keeping pucks to the outside. I think for Gordachuk, he hasn't been tested too much so far, and you have to love the play in the neutral zone for the Dashers right now. Strong, strong first period for them.
Well, we've reached the first intermission. We'll be back after some on-ice festivities and once the ice is cut. You're watching Danbury Hattricks Hockey on the Hattricks YouTube channel. Casey Bryant alongside Zach McGinnis and Jack O'Mara. Don't go anywhere. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, for live coverage of the Danbury Hattricks as they take on the Danville Dashers here at Danbury Arena. Casey Bryant alongside Jack O'Mara, and here for the FBHL out-of-town scoreboard is Zach McGinnis.
Thanks, Casey. Out in Elmira, the Enforcers, they seem angry. In the second period, they are up by 6. It's 7-1 now. Elmira over the Mentor Icebreakers. Kyle Stevens has a pair of goals for the Enforcers. Keep in mind that if Elmira wins that game in regulation, and if the score stays the same here, Elmira will jump Danbury for first place in the Eastern Division. Meanwhile, out in Watertown, Port Huron Prowlers and the Watertown Wolves are tied at 1 through 1 period of play. Out in Battle Creek, Michigan, the Delaware Thunder, the Battle Creek Rumblebees, tied at 1 through 1 period of play. And down in Carolina, the Columbus River Drivers and Carolina Thunderbirds are tied at 1 apiece halfway through the first period. And right here in Danbury, 2-1 in favor of the Danville Dashers.
I think we caught you in a bit of a historical moment here, Zach. You said River Drivers.
Oh, no.
You're caught in 2016. Columbus River Drive, you're caught back in what year was that, 2016?
That was the 2015-16 season. Yeah, and,
Berlin River Drivers?
I'm sorry, the 2016-17
season.
16-17. The Berlin River Drivers, they played at a Notre Dame arena, max capacity 1,600. And on the very last day of the regular season of the last year of the Danbury Titans, they come here to Danbury, they win. They win division game one of the playoffs. They go on to the finals, and then, along with the Titans, disappear into the ether of minor league hockey teams.
Well, we will be honoring said Danbury Titans tomorrow night on Danbury Hockey Alumni Night. Representatives from the Titans, Whalers, Mad Hatters, and Trashers will all be in attendance here tomorrow at Danbury Arena as that puck gets sent up into the netting. And we'll have plenty of representatives for each team, and we're expecting a huge crowd here. And we'll have a banner ceremony as we'll be hoisting banners for each of the best season for the Whalers, Titans, Mad Hatters, and Trashers, and of course honoring the number of number 15, Corey Fulton, a founding member of the 2010 Danbury Whalers.
A founding member and still beloved here in the Hat City.
One of the most popular players in Danbury history, racked up over 400 penalty minutes in his 60 games in his career, and that tells you all you need to know about what Corey's job was when he was out on the ice as that shot gets sent into the catching glove of Dylan Kelly. You know, we were talking with our managing partner here with the Danbury Hattricks, Herm Sorcher, who was also CEO and president of the Danbury Whalers back in the day. And he recalled when Corey Fulton finally scored his first goal as a member of the Danbury Whalers, he said it was the most electric he's ever seen the bench because Fulton was such a team guy. The team was so happy that he was finally able to find the stat sheet.
Go ahead.
Absolutely. I mean, you look at this guy, and he's known for the penalties and his physicality. And when you have a guy who does it, score a ton when he finally gets there, it's almost a sigh of relief for the whole team.
Gullo sends one into the midsection of Dylan Kelly and he holds.
Oh, it's a sigh of relief, but also, I mean, I'm reminded of Cam Jansen when he was on the New Jersey Devils. I think it was his third or fourth season. The Devils are trailing, as usual, to the Washington Capitals. Jansen comes in on the right wing, just launches one far side, almost bar down and in. Chico Resch lost his mind on the Devils broadcast, and the bench went nuts as well.
As the shot gets off a defensive stick and finds its way into the far side corner, Atkins with a setup for Gullo. It goes off of his stick. Atkins picks it up at the far side circle as Brown in front of him. Atkins with a shot, blocker to side by Kelly. Into the corner it goes. Atkins once more springs onto the puck. Forced along the wall by Brown and Shinkarik. Atkins keeps it alive. Terrific stick work to play out in front. Loose puck in front. That one's blocked by the stick of Shinkarik. Still loose, picked up by Bolin Porter. Over to Shane Morrissey at the far side midboards now as he tries to evade a couple of Dasher sticks. Dishes to Bolin Porter on the left wing. Bolin Porter, long pass looking for Shinkarik. Morrissey has to hold up. Now he carries it on the far side blue line. Crossing to Bolin Porter. Bolin Porter has a look to the net. Loses the handle on it for a moment, cycles it down low for Shinkarik. Shinkarik has Bolin Porter at the point, Brown across the way. Morrissey setting the screen in front, he sends it right into the legs of Morrissey. Turnaround shot, save Gordachuk. Stretch pass now, looking for Hein, goes off of a stick and into the hat trick's end.
Well, the game's opened up a little bit more here, guys. Good attack for Danville, back the other way. Danbury comes rushing, and again, that Bunnell, Morrissey, and Shinkarik line just moving the puck so well.
Morrissey's shot gets turned out by Gordachuk, had Anderson planted in front. Now a flittering puck finds its way out to Efimov Barakov. That shot gets sent wide off the stick of Brawson. Picked up by Mealy. slides it to Anderson, who in turn flicks it up to Dearson. Dearson has a man to beat. Dearson on the backhand. His shot stopped by Gornachuk. Another try gets sent wide. Trailing slapper by Bush. Anderson gets rifled wide. Redirected out in front. Kept alive by Anderson as Mealy behind the end line. Manocchio trying to chase after the puck. It'll be flipped out by Brawson. And the Dashers get their goaltender bailing them out, but back in comes Atwell, steered out by Gordachuk. Anderson throws a hard hit on Brawson, keeps the puck in deep. Manocchio behind the end line, takes a check from Mealy. Dearson at the midboards. Loops it around the perimeter of the wall. Dearson throws a check. Dasher's able to get it out to the red line. Now picked up once more. In with a head of steam is Levesque. Has Dearson behind him. Ruiz across the way. Ruiz at the hash marks. Sends it into the corner. Spins away from Troy Murray. Setting it up in front looking for Levesque. Levesque couldn't get a shot off. Now carried up the left wing. Here's Quintos. Thumps it in. Met by Bush Anderson. Bush Anderson up the right wing to Bronner. Bronner in turn sends it up to Ruiz, who whacks it into the attacking zone. Levesque gives chase. Gordachuk stumbled a bit coming out of his net. Settles the puck down. 3:40 gone by here in the second period. Long stretch pass looking for Quintos. Quintos has Sheik with him in the far side corner. Sheik throws a weak check, knocks the puck loose. Behind the net for Nieher. Sheik rolling along the boards for Bronner. Bronner now up the left wing to Levesque. Levesque motoring ahead, has it on his backhand, shanks it up high over the netting. Quintos takes a swing at it. Listmaier keeps it in at the point. Turner off the wall and down the length of the ice it will go. This will be an icing against the Danville Dashers, and we get a stoppage of play 4:09 into the second.
Oh, better start to the period compared to the first for Danbury.
For
now,
sure.
Now they're getting the shots on goal. Gordachuk, again, very aggressively. That's what essentially forced Dearson to run out of space. Dearson sends one through the slot, but a good start of the period for Danbury.
And you see how much speed Dearson was able to get through the neutral zone. He ends up spinning Manocchio around and then, again, misses on that chance, but it kind of ignites the Danbury offense to get going a little bit. Oof.
Down towards Dylan Kelly, and he'll hold on to the puck.
You got to be careful. Puck's bouncing a little bit there. But that's definitely what Danbury wants, much more intensity on the offensive side of things. Being able to cycle their lines through, that Morrissey line starting to lead. Dearson kind of started everything, and if you're able to get two or three lines with consistent attack, eventually the scoring chances are going to build on you. You just have to be able to sustain those types of sequences, and that's really where Danbury needs to start. They're off to a good start here in the second.
Bolin Porter keeps his feet moving and gets it over to Morrissey on the right wing. Morrissey is met by a Danville Dasher in Gullo. Looking up for Hine at the red line. Shinkara takes the puck away. Maneuvers it back to Brown, who finagles it over to the right wing, but it's intercepted by Gullo. Turner now at the far side circle. Has Gullo at the right wing. Leads him at the red line. Entering in is Hine. Has Atkins cutting to the net. Hine sends it wide. Morrissey, one-touch pass, springs Shinkara. 3-on-2 if the hat-tricks hurry. Shinkara with Bolin Porter and Bunnell. Shinkara back to Bunnell. One-time shot. He scores! Gordy Bunnell, we're tied at 2!
I don't think he's going to end up on the score sheet with an assist, but Kendall Bolin Porter, by driving to the net, that opens up Gordy Bunnell. It takes away the eyes of Gordachuk. Again, Bolin Porter, he might not get the actual assist. That goal happens because of his effort.
And you just see how many passes that line was able to complete. It just seemed like Morrissey, Shinkarik to Bunnell, and then Bunnell kind of skated on through, created that 3-on-2. Oh, my goodness, what a finish there for Gordy Bunnell. So much going on, and Gordachuk just pretty much guesses wrong. That's really what you want for Danbury. That energy that they started the period with pays off here, and because Bolin Porter is a forward by trade, he's not afraid to jump into that rush, knows he has help behind him, and that's what creates all that traffic in front. And you just saw the line's chemistry building. I really like that setup with obviously keeping Shinkarik and Morrissey together and then adding a very similar player in Gordy Bunnell on that same line. You see how well they move the puck with each other.
I was just going to mention, Jack, that as Kendall Bolin Porter, he's been playing on the defense – this evening. He's played defense a couple of different times over the last couple of weeks with players coming in and out as that one gets sent into Dylan Kelly's padding. And with all the absences and players shuffling in and out of the lineup, Bolin Porter is finally able to generate a rush opportunity there with Shinkarik and Benali. I'm sure he's been waiting for the opportunity because speed is really Bolin Porter's primary asset that he has in his arsenal.
Oh, you think his eyes just lit up as he as he looks ahead. He sees, all right, two guys in white, two guys in black, and I can jump in on this? Yes, please.
Over to the far side midboards it goes, where Efimov Barakov turns around, tries to get it towards the net. It's instead met by Anderson. Slides it up to Atwell, leads the rush. Atwell trying to get around a defender. Winds and fires, trying to pick a corner and finds glass. Now Efimov Barakov with a lead pass now finds Zylak. Zylak into the corner, forced wide by Sheik. Sheik takes the puck away, sends it into the corner where Koch will give chase. Out to the point, cycling it around, gets it over to Murray. Murray looking for the redirection in the slot, couldn't find the stick of Tyler Quintos. Set up in front, that one gets sent wide. Kept alive now by Niehr. Niehr comes together with Anderson. Anderson loses his lumber. Now Sheik has a body on him, spins away. Niehr trying to provide support for his Danville teammate. He's run into the wall by Atwell. The two of them go tumbling down. Niehr was tied up, wanted to get a holding call. No such luck. Now Quintos gets it out to the slot. Cycling it down low, looking for the stuff-in try on the far side post. And Dylan Kelly with a great poke check to get it away from Niehr.
Yeah, Danbury needed that clear. They're not going to be able to change because of the icing. But you just see how well Danville, not necessarily playing with conviction there, just holding the puck, keeping some time. A couple of nice, good passes. Just weren't able to connect on the final shots there. Good stick by Kelly on that last pass. Well, right now, Danville responding again after the goal. They're able to get sustained offensive attacking time here.
And it's the response that comes off of an odd man rush in favor of Danbury. Aaron Atwell leads the puck up. He has to go all the full 200 feet back to his position. Danville, a great shift, a great response.
Atwell lead pass for Mealy. Mealy sparking a rush now with Dearson. Mealy overskated the puck, and that will come in offsides. Well, they'll say that Mealy lost possession for just long enough.
That's why I'm angry over here, because I thought Mealy had possession the entire way. Obviously, the linesman disagrees, and it's his call that stands.
Yeah, Phil Bronner's pleading the case as well. Looks like he's satisfied with the explanation from the official, but again, look how quickly Danbury was able to get from blue line to blue line. I think Danville needs to just go back to their defensive game plan. They were doing so well for the first 12, 14 minutes of that first period of just clogging the lanes up and not allowing Danbury through the neutral zone whatsoever. That's pretty much vanished over the last 8 minutes or so.
Into the corner it goes. Levesque trying to tie a man up. He comes together with Seth Ensor. Ensor gets the puck up to Gullo. Gullo will send it down towards Kelly. Stops a bouncing puck. Juicy rebound out in front, but Bolin Porter is there to steer it aside. Now rolling puck finds its way to Ruiz, has Levesque joining the rush with him. Surrounded by white sweaters, Ruiz is forced wide, still gets a shot off, and that stop made by Gordichuk. Now out to Brown, kept in at the point, winds and fires. That's a glove save by Gordichuk, and he holds, and some oohs and ahs as Brown got his full weight behind that one.
Got his full weight behind it, and Jesse Gordichuk with the Patrick Waugh flash of the leather. If somebody's in front of the net, that's a much more difficult shot for Gordichuk to handle because Brown can really blast it.
Shinkarik, Morrissey, and Bunnell out with Bush Anderson and Atwell. Countered by Zylak in the faceoff dot. It's won by Shinkarik. Morrissey trying to get a shot off. It's blocked in front by Justin Brawson. Behind the end line it goes. Shinkarik and Bunnell colliding now with Danilik. Danilik trying to win the puck away from Shinkarik. He does terrific work there by Danilik, but not out of the zone just yet. Now here's Efimov Barakov speeding ahead, 2-on-1 developing. He's got Brawson with him. Efimov Barakov broken up by Atwell. Savvy stick work there.
Atwell breaking up a 3-on-1 because Ethan Bush Anderson, he poked at the puck. You either got to get the puck or the body. Bush Anderson got neither.
They will deem the Hattricks entering in offsides and we'll get a stoppage 8 minutes and 24 seconds into the second period. We're tied at 2.
But again, on that last opportunity for Danville, Ethan Bush Anderson, he's holding the blue line, which is good as a defender, but again, you got to get one or the other. If you don't, it's an odd man rush going back the other way. Aaron Atwell with a good breakup.
Entering in now is Dearson. Turning around, looking for the redirection. Kasich was in front. It went off of his skate. Dearson looking for the one-timer in the high slot. Instead, a long shot by Sheik finds its way into the padding of Gordychuk, and that is Zach Sheik's first shot on goal as a professional hockey player.
Easy save, too, for Gordychuk. Seeing eye saved, no traffic in front, but that's what you want to do. Just get the puck to the net, reset, get the faceoff going, and again, this line has created some chances here in the second especially.
You mentioned how there's nobody in front of the net. That's the disadvantage of Casper Dearson being so high looking for that one-timer.
Bouncing puck finds its way over towards Dylan Kelly, and he holds at the near side post.
11:13 to go in the second. It's been a pretty entertaining one so far. Really back and forth action between these two teams. Danbury's out shooting Danville by a 17-12 margin, but it seems like the Dashers might be getting the better opportunities so far.
I think so. I mean, they've had some good chances. Kelly looked a little unsure-handed, and they're looking for those lower shots, going towards, you know, bouncing pucks in front of Kelly. Not necessarily a ton of traffic, but they're trying to create some unsuredness from the goaltender, and it's worked a couple times. Danbury, they just haven't had enough clear opportunities to the net, except for, obviously, the Anderson play and then that three-on-two. Again, when they gain the blue line with speed, those are their best chances so far.
Here's Quintos up the left wing. He's got Brown in front of him. Quintos has Atkins lurking in that slot. Koch also joining the rush. Atkins now behind the end line, taking a step in and looking for a shot was Ensor. It gets blocked in front. Now Ensor doing work with Bolin Porter in the corner. Bolin Porter has Atkins surrounding him as well. Puck will squib out towards the blue line and cross it. Hein will retrieve. Gets around Dearson, maneuvers to his left, ambles into the attacking zone. Looking for the sharp angle try, goes off the blocker of Kelly. It'll be kept alive. Oh, a big open ice check there as Johnny Ruiz was upended, and that will be a penalty.
And it's going to be a penalty, and I think there might be even more of a response as Mitch Atkins goes up high on Johnny Ruiz.
Johnny Ruiz got clotheslined there.
That's a dangerous play. It's only going to be 2 minutes, I believe, for roughing against Atkins. But now we get to see Danbury on the power play. 10:08 remaining in the second period. We're halfway through this game. Let's see what Danbury's man advantage can do. Their power play has been incredibly strong this season.
And Danville's been relatively disciplined in this game. Obviously, you don't want to take that penalty. And for Atkins, who's been such a strong player in this game, you're taking almost your best guy on the ice, putting him in the box for 2 minutes, and let a strong, strong, hot power play team come out on the ice and see if they could take their first lead.
Mealy gets it back to Morrissey. Ruiz at the far side circle. Ruiz, Mealy, Bronner, Morrissey, and Shinkarik, the five forward unit out for the Danbury Hattricks. Bronner cycles it looking for Mealy. One hands it ahead as Ruiz in the corner. Digs it out. Looking towards the net. Rings it off the iron. Now Morrissey at the far side circle. A drop pass to no one. And it'll be picked up in a rush opportunity. Oh, Turner forgot the puck. Evimov Barakov will settle it down. And the Hattricks catch a break and keep it in deep. Has Morrissey in front. Looking for him. Shank just wide. Now a setup in front again. And Mealy couldn't get a stick on it. Back pass to Ruiz. Sends a slapper off the end boards. Morrissey fields at the far side post. Bronner along the boards finds Ruiz at the point. 1:15 to go in the power play. Bronner setting the screen in front. Errant shot finds its way out to Morrissey as Shinkarik across the way. Looking for him and finds him with a saucer pass. Shinkarik maneuvers to his right to Ruiz in the corner. Ruiz to Bronner at the post. Looking for the setup in front. Morrissey's shot blocked in front by Efimov Barakov. And it goes up out of play with 1:01 to go in the power play, 9:09 to go in the period.
You see the blind backhand pass by Phil Bronner. That's what Johnny Ruiz was looking for that first time. Bronner just couldn't quite get the stick on it, but not a bad setup so far.
Yeah, and Morrissey makes that mistake. He kind of does that back pass to no one in particular, makes up for it by winning that puck back and then coming back across. Mealy sent across that pass for Morrissey, and he just couldn't get his stick down. It was kind of a weak attempt with the stick in his hand, and everyone in the building saw Morrissey kind of streak towards that near side post. He was just unable to get the clean shot away. Good couple of chances there for Danbury.
Dearson out with Bunnell, Levesque, Anderson, and Atwell, the five-man power play unit. Neher out there with Quintos, as well as Murray and Danilik. for the penalty kill. 35 seconds to go. Atwell, the lone defender out on the ice for the Hattricks. Backhands it ahead, has a couple of sticks in his midsection, maintains possession of the puck. Anderson has Levesque joining him. Levesque fields, has Bunnell behind him, gets it to him. Three Hattricks up top, gets it to Anderson. At the far side circle, shot through traffic, he scores! Corey Anderson with his second of the game, and the Hattricks have the lead!
Corey Anderson goes upstairs again. He's a left-handed shot. He gets it on the far right wing circle. It's a curl towards the top of the slot. I'm not sure if Gordychuk had his eyes on this one. There could have been a scream, but Corey Anderson, what a goal. Danbury with the lead.
His ninth power play goal of the game, and I said as that line was ninth power play goal of the season, I should say. And as that line's out there, I see Anderson a lot more space, a lot more space. When our team's going to learn to pick him up on the power play? If you allow him all that space to shoot, he's going to pick his spot. And yes, for the second time today, he goes top shelf.
And for the first time in the game, the Danbury Hattricks have themselves the lead. Anderson's 24th of the season, his ninth on the man advantage, as Jack just mentioned. Morrissey enters back in, flitters it ahead, and Mattias Kasich will give chase. Now set up in front, Morrissey in front, set up in front, off the crossbar!
That was in. That was in.
And they will wave it off. Oh, it hit the back of the net.
That was in.
Ooh, Gordychuk was down on his belly. The horn sounded. And it certainly looked like from this vantage point that hit the top of the net. Well, for Morrissey and Mealy, you had two skaters in the blue paint with no Danville Dashers around them. So Morrissey elects to pass it to the far side post, and Mealy, Gordychuk got a piece of it, and they will say he got enough.
And I'm surprised there's not more of an argument coming from the Hattricks bench here.
Well, it's so hard to tell from that vantage point, you know?
I'm right there with you, Jack, because, again, from our angle, it clearly looked like it was in. I'm taking a look at the YouTube stream right now. I want to see a replay of this myself. And for the first time, I don't have Phil Bronner's body in the way when I do this.
Well, we don't have the benefit of, you know, the goal cams or NBC it, those super slow-mo, super zoomed-in shots. But
oh, this is purely for my own edification. Because the score's going to stay 3-2. I mean, give credit to Gordychuk, because even if the puck got behind him, there was no whistle on the play. Gordychuk's still competing. He gets his leg over the puck. And just like that, it stays a one-goal game.
You play till the whistle blows.
And you wonder if Morrissey ends up trying to shoot that himself, does he get a better chance and a more clear goal than we saw? But you could see all the fans right there in section 105, especially behind the net as well, were pointing, saying, that's in, that's in. And the Hattricks get robbed of what would have been a huge insurance goal.
Well, the crowd's still a bit antsy from the non-goal, but nevertheless, play goes on. And for the Danville Dashers, you have a chance now to really sheath the dagger as they enter in just offsides. Danville may or may not have caught a break. We may never know. 7:51 remains in the second period. Still a one-goal game, 3-2 in favor of the Danbury Hattricks.
Maybe next year we'll get that NBC money.
Keep holding out hope.
I have been for years.
Bolin Porter back in his own end. Over to Steve Brown. Well, we're right in the middle of MSG Network and Nesson. We're kind of caught in that tweener state.
Can we combine them and make Messin?
Exactly. So you have so much at play there. You have two major networks now. Why have one when you can have two?
Exactly. Why not?
They'll pick up FPHL action, no problem.
Hey, I heard SNY is still looking for active programming.
Anything's better than the Mets, right?
Well.
That's coming from a Met fan.
I was going to say, how's spring training working out for you so far?
Well, we did cut Tim Tebow.
No.
Yes.
Did you really?
The Mets, unfortunately, did cut Tim Tebow.
I figured he was going to be there till he was 40.
Tebow time on hiatus.
Is his batting average ever over 200?
I'm not sure what was, as a stuff in try now at the far side, shanked wide by Neher. I'm not sure what was worse, his batting average or his completion percentage in the NFL.
Oof.
To the near side circle, that one gets sent wide. And it'll be played ahead by Dearson. Dearson has Minocchio in front of him, taken away. Dearson looking across the way for Bunnell. It's broken up. Great back check there by Quintos.
Great back check, but again, it seems like Danbury's starting to figure out Minocchio because that's the third time now he's been burned.
Yeah, Dearson's been a catapult in that category as well. He's been able to get across the blue line so well in this game.
Here's Levesque, has a couple of dashers around him. Brawson forcing him up along the wall. Back to Listmeyer. Off the end boards it goes. Ruiz and Bronner a bit too close together. Puck now goes out to the far side corner. It will be picked up by Hine. Rush opportunity for the dashers if they hurry. Up comes Hawgood. Sends it towards the net. That one stopped by Kelly as he comes way out of his net to stop that puck.
Well, he comes way out of his net, and then Gullo gives him a bit of a snow shower. Why is it always the second period? Friday night second period is when everything starts happening here. Everybody, first period, everybody's still shaking off their legs, getting reacquainted with each other. Second period, it's on. And this is what I'm expecting for the rest of the weekend. It's entertaining at the very least.
And I think reacquainted is the perfect word because these two teams haven't seen each other since November, the beginning of November.
Well, it's a lot like, I always equate it to a boxing match, you know. That first round is really just about feeling each other out. What kind of mood are they going to be in? It isn't really until the middle rounds that really things start to pick up a little bit.
You clearly didn't watch many Mike Tyson fights.
Before my time. Although the most recent heavyweight bout, I suppose, that's fresh in my mind is Anthony Joshua and Andy Ruiz, where that really picked up in the third round.
Oh, you didn't tune in for Wilder Fury?
Wilder Fury.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. That's more recent. Although, really, I learned everything I know about boxing from the Rocky movies, and as we all know, it doesn't pick up, really, until the 15th round.
Or
until then, you're fine.
Well, the 15th round or the 5th or 6th or 7th movie. How many movies are we up to now?
We are up to, well, there were 6 Rocky movies and 2 Creeds with a third one in development.
Right.
Do the Creeds count towards the Rocky?
I don't think so.
Really?
It's a bit like how The Hobbit ties into The Lord of the Rings, you know? They are still the same property.
You wouldn't consider The Lord of the Rings' 4th movie to be The Hobbit, would you?
No, but you would consider it the prequel, I suppose.
I mean, it's a franchise. I don't know. Hey, guys, look, there's a hockey game.
Anderson tries to play it towards the net, taken down. Kasich with a turnaround shot gets redirected up into the netting after rudely interrupting our Rocky conversation, and it goes up into the netting with 5:37 to go.
Do you consider Creed a spinoff? I mean, it clearly is.
It's a continuation of an ongoing plot line. It's an epic saga. You're watching an opera unfold before you. Where everyone is related to everyone. It's like a grounded in reality Star Wars.
I'm trying to think of another movie series that you would compare to. Maybe the Harry Potter, and now you have the
Fantastic
Beasts. Fantastic Beasts, exactly. It's not necessarily the same series.
It's a cinematic universe.
It's the universe, exactly.
Meanwhile, back at the ranch, dumped into the attacking zone, and it will roll around the top of the glass and go up into the netting. And we'll see where they decide the faceoff should come.
Should come outside. Nobody on Danbury's team managed to touch that puck as it took it. I'm not sure if it hit somewhere on the boards or what, but it suddenly just hopped up and out of play. And Justin Brawson would like an explanation, but faceoff should come out into the neutral zone, and maybe they'll line it up at center ice, although not sure why it would be there. Well, now that we have time, back to movies.
Perhaps it's just fresh in my mind because I did rewatch Creed 2 the other night. That could be why.
Well, it looks like Justin Brawson Esquire won his case, and they're going to move the faceoff back into the Danbury zone, and Billy McCreary not happy with it.
Faceoff will be to the right of Dylan Kelly. Shinkarik will win it back. Aaron Atwell flips it over to Gordy Bunnell on the left wing side. Met by a couple of hat tricks, but keeping it alive is Efimov Barakov. Bush Anderson back to Atwell. Atwell over to Bunnell on the left wing, pinching in and keeping it alive is Ensor. He gets it over towards Dylan Kelly with a chopping shot. And Kelly will settle it down and freeze the puck. A lot of whistles here in this five-minute mark.
Yeah, it's been a choppy couple of minutes. And just teams, again, I think the getting reacquainted has factored into it. Guys just getting a little bit chippy and, again, trying to just find a loose bolt or option here, just trying to get moving forward. And Danbury, since their phantom goal was taken away, they haven't really been able to sustain any offensive chances.
Ruiz trying to get it up to Bronner, who in turn looks up ice for Levesque. Here's Quintos kicking it ahead for himself. Quintos has a defender in front of him. Flashy glove save that gets some oohs and ahs from the crowd. That might have been heading wide, but Kelly still puts a little mustard on that one. Lets the crowd know he's got it.
Oh, crowd certainly sounded impressed as well. There was there's an audible ooh out of that one. But a nice save by Dylan Kelly. He's not coming out too aggressively right now. It's a little bit of a different look for him. It means that there's more net to shoot at.
Bolin Porter carrying it ahead, leading the rush, trying to split the defense, met by Troy Murray, and it'll be knocked back towards the blue line. Nyheer now turns around. Has Scott Koch up with him. Koch, back pass now for Nyheer. Nyheer trying to get around Steve Brown, knocks him off the puck. Behind the net, and it looks like it will go onto the side of the net, and the puck will be stopped.
You look at that last sequence, Bolin Porter with a head of steam, and all of the dashers who are skating back just kind of waiting. And as soon as Bolin Porter crosses the blue line, they all kind of converge on him and force him to either move the puck, and eventually he gets knocked off of it. Much better job of Danville coming together, some good defensive positioning there over these last 4 minutes. I think they've really shorthanded themselves up back at their own blue line.
Jack, I think you're absolutely right. And Danbury, they need to adjust to that. Start with the dump and chase. I know they like having their possession, as Dylan Kelly makes a save, but I know they like having their possession. Dump it in deep, because like you said, Bolin Porter hits the blue line and suddenly there are four dashers, a herd of them, right in front of them, and there's nothing Bolin Porter can do.
Yeah, you're not going to make a pass with four guys around. You're really virtually no options. He's the first man in the rush. It's not going to hurt. If he dumps the puck in deep, he can still get back as the defender and allow his forwards to come in. I think you're right, Zach. He just needs to be a little bit more smarter with the puck there.
Hine with Atkins behind him. Atkins looking for Hine, set up in front. That one's blocked by Atwell. Anderson trying to one-hand it up and swipes at it with the left hand. Nifty little move there. That was like a field hockey move. He had the stick in one hand and was still able to get it up. Now here's Anderson again, up with Dearson. One hands it over to Dearson, poked away by Bonocchio.
And Corey Anderson can do all this with one hand on his stick. Imagine if it was two.
Now carrying it up ahead, Gullo trying to get around Bolin Porter. Bolin Porter kicks it into the corner where Atkins will field for the Dashers. Atkins loses the handle. Atwell lifts it up, and Shinkarik couldn't find where the puck was, and neither could Haugood. The two of them looking around, wondering where it is. Gordachuk imploring them to come back towards him. Now Hine once more looks up ice. Bouncing puck, settled down by Kelly, and he'll hold in an offensive zone faceoff for Danville.
You know, as much as it's annoying when the Danville Dashers, they're doing a good job. They put the puck on goal, and then they follow up on their shot. It makes the goaltender uncomfortable. However, I know Dylan Kelly. I know Dylan Kelly, say, in shootout situations where if his mind can hit another level where he's, well, quite frankly, playing angry but plays well.
Dylan Kelly will get a piece of that one, and it will go into the near side corner where a one-time shot by Haugood gets through traffic and redirects off the glass. Now another setup in front as Kelly will hold on to that one, and Steve Brown with a bit of extracurricular activities as there were a couple of dashers in front of him, specifically Patrick Zylak.
Now you haven't seen a ton of traffic in front of the net for Danville in this game, but that one's a much better opportunity. Just get guys to the front of the net, and I think, Casey, that might have gotten a piece of the iron as well on its way in. A very, very good deflection up front. You have to see more of that, especially if you want to beat Dylan Kelly's big frame. He's had a much better second period, I think, than his first.
Face off one cleanly by the Dashers. Haugood, long shot, gets off the end boards and covered up once more by Dylan Kelly. A lot of face-offs over by Dylan Kelly, so a lot of face-off practice for the boys out there.
And he's not playing a lot of games. Kelly just slapping his glove down, even when it's dumped in, bouncing on him a little bit. He doesn't want to put it down and pass it out. he just says, I'm just going to eat this up because I know that if I just take care of the puck, nothing bad's going to happen here. Or just rely on your centerman to win some faceoffs in the defensive zone.
Ethan Bush-Anderson up for Nicola Levesque, who takes a hard check from behind. Lost his footing a bit. Now entering back in are the Dashers. Shot from a sharp angle, saved by Kelly. Kept alive behind the net. Here's Koch looking for the setup in front. Shot wide. And it'll roll out into the neutral zone. Koch once more entering in as Atwell and Bush-Anderson. Koch on the backhand sends it off the side of the net. Bush-Anderson will skate out to safety with 2:15 to go in the second period. Hattricks leading 3-2. Bronner sends it over towards Gordichuk. Stick handles for a bit. Levesque takes it away as Ruiz in front of the net if they can get it to him. Koch lifting it up and out. Quintos ahead with Niehr. Quintos speeding ahead. Sends one right into the padding underneath the chin of Dylan Kelly, and he holds.
So there you go. That's the best entry Danbury's had in a while. And then Nicola Levesque, he's so anticipatory with the puck. He sees what Gordichuk's going to do, and Gordichuk just flips it behind him. He reads that perfectly, but then he doesn't move the puck quick enough. He kind of gets staple-gunned against the boards. Not really much to do. Danville's able to reset in their own zone, get the puck out, create a shot, not 10 seconds later.
Yeah, the score might be 3-2 in favor of Danbury, but the momentum's Danville's right now.
Ensor pokes it ahead, met by Mealy. Now over to Anderson, takes it away from Hine. Anderson dumps it in deep, and Gordichuk with a good job of just holding on to that one. And now, for the first time in what feels like a long time, the Danbury Hattricks will have an offensive zone faceoff.
Exactly. Nothing wrong with that by Corey Anderson. Put it on goal and try and get something started offensively with the faceoff.
I really liked Anderson's game tonight. Obviously, the two goals help that. But he's been physical. He's been smart. He's had a little bit of everything in this one. And it's just made the job of the Dashers in all three zones of the game that much harder because of how pesky Anderson has been in this game, in the neutral zone, picking pucks off, being physical up against the boards, and again, just the open space that he's found on his two goals is unprecedented.
Anderson at the red line will have a delayed call going against Danville as Casper Dearson was upended back in the defensive zone for the Hattricks. Trailing shot by Dearson looking for revenge and a blocker saved by Gordichuk. And Casper Dearson has a lot of snow covering his jersey.
Oh, a lot of snow because he got upended behind the play. Not sure what the call is going to. They're going to call it tripping. Could have been interference. Could have been a couple other things as well. But Dearson, as he sees that loose puck come out to him, again, you see his eyes get wide because, well, that's one heck of a way to get back into him.
Faceoff will be to the left of Gordichuk. Ruiz out with Bronner, Mealy, Morrissey, and Shinkarik. Quintos will take the draw for the Dashers, ties up Ruiz, gets support from Niehr, who turns around and sends it down the length of the ice. Shinkarik will race after it. Dylan Kelly will stymie the puck and leave it behind the safety of his own cage. Quintos smokes out Shinkarik, who leaves it for Morrissey. Final minute of play here in the second period. If there is no scoring, the power play will carry over into the final frame. Here's Mealy, leaves it for Morrissey as he enters in on the left side. Down low for Bronner. Bronner has a pick set for him in the form of Morrissey. Ensor trying to dig the puck out along the wall. Ensor and Ruiz come together along the midboards. Niehr picks it up and sends it out into the neutral zone. Quintos carries it ahead with Shinkarik in front of him. Quintos enters in now. Lead pass for Niehr. Niehr with a nifty move gets a shot off and a stop by Kelly.
Nice shot by Niehr. He knows that he has five forwards out on the ice. He takes advantage.
Here's Shinkarik up for Ruiz. Morrissey on the left side. Ruiz along the wall with 5 seconds to go. Bronner has Morrissey in front of the net as well as Bunnell. To Ruiz, 2 seconds in one. The imploration for shoot, redirection just wide. And that will do it for the second period. 47 seconds of power play time will carry over into the third period, but the Danbury Hattricks come roaring back here in the second period and find themselves on top 3-2. And what a game it's been so far for number 27, Corey Anderson.
Absolutely. He's been sharp, and he comes out and he scores an absolute electric goal on the power play there. Puts Danbury in the lead, gets the building going a little bit. A much better period for the Hattricks in this one. Obviously outscore the Dashers 2-0 in the second frame, so they're happy about that. I like the way that Kelly responded. He looked good. He looked sure-handed. Very, very smart. Danville, though, they're winning a ton of board battles. They're constantly outworking the Hattricks for the puck right now. That's going to help them in the third period, especially if Danbury starts to kind of wind down a little bit. Their energy gets drained a little bit. That's going to go in favor of the Dashers. This thing is far from over.
They're winning the board battles. They're winning the neutral zone battles as well. You know, like I said, Danbury has the lead, but especially that last half of the second period, I thought it was all Danville. The puck was down in Danbury's end. Like you mentioned, Dylan Kelly, his glove getting a workout. Danbury, they have the intermission now, have a couple orange slices, settle things down. They have the lead for the reason, for a reason. They just have to get back to their game.
Have some orange slices as if we're in the movie Kicking and Screaming here.
Or any youth organization.
Yes. Are you part of, what is it, the Connecticut State Pee Wee Tournament going on right now?
Yeah,
in
the CSC Pee Wees and, I don't know,
and
midgets, is that too old?
I think they're bantams.
Bantams,
yeah.
Sure.
So
sure.
You have a lot of kids playing here, hence why the start time tonight was at 7:20 and not the customary 7. Nevertheless, we're here playing FPHL hockey and a busy night in Connecticut hockey, really, as the Connecticut Whale in action tonight for their playoff matchup, which you can catch during this intermission on Twitch TV by subscribing to the NWHL channel. You can check them out as they take on the Buffalo Buttes up in Buffalo. And the Danbury Colonials are getting ready to take on the Long Beach Sharks tonight on My Hockey TV. So stay tuned for some Danbury Hattricks hockey on the Hattricks YouTube channel. Casey Bryant alongside Jack O'Mara and Zach McGinnis. Don't go anywhere.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Danbury Hattricks Hockey on the Hattricks YouTube channel. Casey Bryant alongside Zach McGinnis and Jack O'Mara. And we apologize for a little bit of a delay here at Danbury Arena as we are having some Zamboni malfunctions, such as life and in the FPHL. But, you know, you make do. And you make, when life gives you lemons, you make do.
Unfortunately, I found my Chuck-a-puck much too late to get in on the running.
There was a Chuck-a-puck that was thrown during the first period, so if you're really feeling up to it, just talk it from here.
Third period, say they're on a breakaway, just give it a little fling.
Well, you were saying before, if you remember, back in the first period when it was thrown out onto the ice, you said that kid has a better arm than I do. This is your chance to prove yourself wrong.
There you go.
This is your opportunity, Zach.
I think it's going to really depend on the loft that I can get on this. I mean, this is foam. Not much to it.
Would you throw it kind of like this, or would you try to frisbee it?
See, if I throw it like this, I'm going to get more distance, but I feel like it's going to tail off. Like my golf shot, it's just going to curl.
Right. I feel like you have less of an aerodynamic advantage if you throw it like this. I feel like frisbeeing it is the way to go.
If you frisbee it, now you get the lift off the back of this, float it all the way across.
Well, we have experience throwing the carrots. We haven't been able to throw the chuck-a-pucks yet.
I pass the chuck-a-puck over to you.
Well, speaking of the carrots, you know, it's always something that fans notice in our group chats on YouTube. They always say, especially teams that are visiting Danbury for the first time, like Danville is this evening, you see in the chat, what are the carrots? Well, the carrots are a Danbury tradition at this point now. You throw them out after the first goal is scored and closest to center ice wins a prize. But you are right, Jack, in that we experienced it before. There was a carrot toss competition as part of a promotion we had back in December where the closest to center ice won a Nintendo Switch Lite. And those things are tricky.
It's tough. And you have to kind of throw it with the end of the carrot, meaning the green end, out. So you want to kind of sling that at almost like you would throw a football. Same idea.
But it's tough to get a spiral.
It is. It really is.
Maybe underhand you can get a better spiral.
But then you're not going to get the distance or the height you might want on it.
But this is why I give credit to whoever brought real carrots here.
Yes.
You can get some distance on those.
Well, those will actually have some density to them. Those you can actually hurl onto the ice and you'll actually get it to travel.
Yes. The foam part, that's a tough one.
That is tricky. But nevertheless, you know, it's all worth it for the cash prize in the end, right? If you're able to get it close to center.
Oh, yeah, I'll take that.
I tell you, the hard thing, in my eyes, it's always the chuck-a-pucks because you have to throw it into a top hat onto center ice. And I remember when we first started that, I'm thinking, no one's going to get it in there. It's gotten in three times.
Yeah.
It got in both times last time, last time that we were at home ice.
Not bad.
That is like lightning striking twice. That's unbelievable.
I feel bad for the person who got that on the second night, though.
Yeah.
Because every night that the prize goes unclaimed, it goes up, I think, either $25 or $50 a piece, and it keeps going and going. So the guy on the first night, he walks away with a pretty nice prize. Second guy, $100. Just as difficult. That's not fair. I don't like that.
Well, that's the price you pay. Maybe you think about not purchasing chuck-a-pucks.
It's like
the lottery.
Exactly.
You have to wait for it to build up.
Mm.
My wife made a rule for me. I can only buy lottery tickets when the jackpot's over $1 billion now.
Is that because of your gambling habits? Like, why is that?
Because it's the lottery. You're not going to win. You know you're not going
to
win.
It could happen to anybody.
You're from New Jersey. Sports gambling is legal there.
Yeah. It is legal now. I haven't lost any money on the Jets yet, but just you wait.
Why would you? See, betting on your own team is such a philosophical no-no.
No, I'm a Jets fan. I'd bet against them.
All right, well, see, that you actually might have a point
exactly.
there.
Exactly.
But see, I could never bet for my own team, if only just because if that team lost, I already feel the sting. Mm-hmm. I don't need to feel it twice knowing that I've also lost money as a result of it.
Casey was actually unintentionally punny there because the Cincinnati Stingers were the old WHA team. It's rare that you get to connect them together like that.
I mean, Where do we find this guy?
Well, Zach has been around minor league hockey for quite some time now. Yes. At this point, you're the elder statesman of our booth here, hence why we're going back to the Berlin River Drivers. Yes. Earlier in this broadcast. Mm-hmm. So tomorrow for Danbury Hockey Alumni Night, as we honor the Trashers, the Whalers, the Titans, the Mad Hatters, that's got to be quite the culmination for you, as you've worked in the FPHL for almost a decade now.
You know, I was speaking with my wife about this yesterday. I saw the photo that our Twitter account sent out of the banners hanging, you know, a bit of a preview for that. I never thought I would see those logos again. And, you know, I've got memories of the Danbury Whalers against the Watertown Privateers. Tim Richter scoring a shorthanded goal halfway through the second period. I thought the roof was going to come off this place. And especially here in the Federal Hockey League, there is been a multitude of teams that come on through, whether it's the Berlin River Drivers, the Berkshire Battalion, the Brewster Bulldogs. The list goes on and on and on. The one team we did not see was the Southwest Pennsylvania Magic.
Can you get more generic?
Well, yes. They played at the Rossover Ice Gardens. They played a game, folded, and were immediately replaced by the Steel City Warriors, who had the worst record and the worst start to their organizational history until the Battle Creek Rumblebees.
God bless the Rumblebees. And they're trying.
And speaking of the Battle Creek Rumblebees, out in Serial City, USA.
Oh, boy.
The Delaware Thunder are taking a 4-1 lead into the third period.
Well, the Delaware Thunder are in desperate need of that game, as they are slowly trying to claw their way back into the playoffs because the Mentor Icebreakers have forgotten how to hockey.
They're in a free fall right now. It's nothing's working out well in Mentor. And Delaware, they have this section of their schedule against Battle Creek. If they can take advantage of that, they're right back into things.
Absolutely. They're slowly starting to climb up that ladder and starting to make up the point differential. And, Jack, the playoff picture in the Eastern Division right now is so tight up top. And then you have the chance for a dramatic, improbable late-season comeback for the Delaware Thunder. And looking ahead, April 4th and 5th, right here at Danbury Arena, you're going to have the Delaware Thunder potentially playing to clinch that playoff spot.
Absolutely. They're the controllers of their own destiny here. They have to produce victories in a timely manner. It's life or death right now for the Thunder. And we saw them when they were here. They are a tough out. They're not necessarily a team that's going to be in and out of the playoffs. I think that they have a really good shot, especially if Mentor continues to struggle. Danbury, if they hold this lead, which is very, very tight right now, if they are able to hold off and win the Eastern Division in the regular season, you might see Delaware back here on this ice just a weekend after the final regular season weekend.
And the standings, as you just saw on your screen, are very tight. The Danville Dashers are here at Danbury Arena. It's still within striking distance if they can catch the Port Huron Prowlers. And Port Huron Prowlers do have a difficult schedule down the stretch, including three games against these Danbury Hattricks. There is still the chance, with the three-point swing in this FPHL season, that the Danville Dashers could be hosting and have the home ice advantage against Port Huron in round number one.
Absolutely. And the fans in Danville, especially at playoff time, they come out in droves. That place gets hopping. It's had a couple renovations over the last few years. It's one of your older style arenas, one of the old barns, and the atmosphere in those places, especially when the folks of Danville feel that, it is not an easy place to play. But Danbury, you can say the same thing about this arena. You know, about 3,000 seats all told, or 3,000 on the capacity when you include standing room. This place gets loud as well. And you mentioned the Carrots at the beginning. At least for the folks in Danville, they've been around since the Whaler years themselves. It used to be whales that were thrown out onto the ice. No prize in those days. It was throw them out
there. You did it for the love
of it. You did it for the love of the whale.
Which, speaking of the whale, the NWHL playoffs are going on right now, so I hope during this intermission you had a chance to catch some of that on twitch.tv/NWHL.
There you go.
As they were taking on the Buffalo Buttes, currently up in Buffalo in round one of the Isabel Cup playoffs. The Whales take a 2-1 lead, coached by Colton Orr, former New York Ranger, and captained by Shannon Doyle. And that team takes a 2-1 lead into the first intermission. That would be a big win for the Connecticut Whale. They have not won a playoff game since 2016, trying to make a little history here tonight.
Well, it'd be a big win, but just consider how the Whale started their season, and now they find themselves in the playoffs. Moreover, they have a lead in the game one. For those women, it keep your heads where they got to be because it's finally clicking. It's working now.
And I think they have a balanced team. You know, we've been saying that all year long. And once Colton Orr kind of stepped into his head coach role, remember he was in Canada doing a figure skating competition
for
a couple of months. So your head coach is not there. There's a little bit missing. Once he stepped in into the realm, you saw that the Whale started to connect on different levels. Obviously, the wins were still hard to come by for them, but you saw the compete level was there.
Well, interim head coach Laura Brennan is a terrific coach in her own right, but her specialty as a goaltender herself is goaltending. So she works very closely with Brooke Waleko and Sonia Shelley and Cassandra Goyette to make sure that their goalies are all in top playing condition, and Brooke Waleko has been nothing short of outstanding this season for the NWHL and for the Whale. And once Colton came in, Colton Orr, his whole MO is check it. It's tenacity. It's playing along the boards, playing smart, and he fixed the penalty kill from being a 40% operation now up to 75%.
Yep.
They doubled their penalty kill efficiency rating by the end of the season, which is nothing short of remarkable. And the Whale, we wish them all the best of luck here tonight as we're rooting you on from your home rink here in the Hat City. Meanwhile, here at Danbury Arena, getting back to the contest at hand as the Zamboni is out on the ice.
It's alive.
You can hear a sarcastic Bronx cheer coming up from the crowd as the Zamboni hits the ice. So we do still have a little bit of time before we get back to the third period. But nevertheless, the third period ahead with this long layover, how is it going to affect the momentum of play? Because the Hat-Tricks still have 47 seconds of a power play carried into the final frame. How is this layover going to affect
you? I'm assuming they remember that they have those 47 seconds. Because I was mingling down by the Danville locker room, and I asked their coach, you know, how do you handle this? He goes, it's tough, but it's a good hockey game. Both teams have to go through it. And that, I thought, was a good point, because as bad, you know, as long as this delay has been, it equally affects both teams. They're both going to be, they both have to deal with the same ice.
That's an excellent point, because in really any sport, whenever someone talks about the elements, it's always both teams going through it. When there's a football game and there's driving snow or rain, the other team's going through it too. When you're playing in extreme heat in baseball, like down in Arlington, Texas, and it's getting to be 105 down on the field, the other team is still playing with that too. So both sides have to manage that kind of chaos. So Jack, you were an athlete yourself. In the locker room right now, as you're still trying to stay sharp, what do you do to try to keep into that mental frame rate?
There are a lot of guys moving around, moving their legs, just trying to, you know, stay hot, essentially. It's a long layoff, and it kind of reminds me, again, kind of apples and oranges here, but you look at the Super Bowl, how long that halftime is compared to the normal 15-minute halftime, it's almost double. So you have to be able to just find a way. Every guy kind of has their own way to approach it. Guys will stay loose. There's probably not a lot of conversating going on, because especially myself, I would like to stay focused. I wouldn't talk a lot if there's a longer layoff. Everybody has their own approach to it, and it becomes, not only do we have to fight against Danville now, or vice versa, Danville fighting against Danbury, we got to fight against ourselves, because we have to find a way to get back into this game with or without the opponent on that ice.
And you made fun of me for the orange slices before. I'm willing to bet both locker rooms would appreciate that.
Well, between the apples, the oranges, the carrots, we're making ourselves a fruit salad here. I don't know.
Yeah, we are very healthy here in the Hat City. It's a new day.
Look, my lunch was pasta and chicken covered in cheese.
Like,
listen, I don't purport to be healthy. that was my pregame. It was a big lunch.
I had a bacon, egg, and cheese, and I had a cheeseburger.
Bacon, egg, and cheese, and a cheese. So you're really trying to die.
There you go.
Trying to get the cardiac arrest.
I'm being very healthy.
Protein, right.
Exactly.
Yeah. That's what that is.
You know what? Next time I'll get something protein style from McDonald's and watch them look at me like I have three.
Well, they
heads.
Just switched over to the 100% chicken or whatever they got going on now.
Again?
What was it before?
You know,
I'm not a very good McDonald's spokesperson.
See, you guys are
good thing they're not a sponsor.
No,
you guys are younger than me. Do you remember the gray chicken nuggets, the dark meat chicken nuggets?
I don't.
Good, because they were terrible. So growing up, I think it was around 03, 04 is when McDonald's went to 100% white meat, which really makes me curious as to what they switched over to now. And then when I was in college, I had the opportunity to spend a semester over in China. I found out where those dark meat nuggets went. They were over there. They tasted as abysmal as I remember. See, you guys don't remember that.
I'm still trying to catch up on my McDonald's history by watching the McMillions documentary.
That's how you're doing it.
Well, yeah, got to do it somehow, which is apparently going to be made into a movie. Reportedly, Ben Affleck and Matt Damon.
That is really?
Wow. Well, they have the story of the founder, obviously, Michael Keaton.
That's true, a great movie.
Yeah. I didn't know Michael Keaton started McDonald's.
Well, now you know. He was Batman and he started McDonald's.
And Birdman, too.
Yeah.
The dad jokes over here from the actual father.
The actual father. 9:44, little Patrick, probably asleep. Going to wake up in about an hour. He'll be mad. And I'll still be here, so.
Which I'm
sorry,
sure,
honey.
I'm sure your wife Jen is thrilled about that.
Oh, God bless her and the family members who have come on over. My mother-in-law has been absolutely fantastic, and I hope we can edit this in post so she doesn't have record of that. But she has. She's been absolutely fantastic. My father, my sister, her. It really does take a village, and I'm. Gosh, I'm sleep deprived. But
as you've been for the last couple of months since Patrick was born.
Yeah, he is. He's 14 weeks old now.
Wow.
If he sleeps more than 5 hours, it's worth throwing a party. We're still doing the bottle.
To be fair, my parents still say the same thing about me. So.
Well, that's true. Do you can at least burp yourself though.
Yeah, but it's more fun to have someone do it for you. I mean, that's what the comforts of home are for.
Well, that's very true. Although I've discovered a new trick. Called sleep feeding. Have you guys heard of this before?
I can't say that I have.
You take the baby. Baby's still asleep. Sit the baby up. Baby's still asleep. Take bottle. Shove in baby's mouth. Baby's still asleep, but baby starts eating. It was the easiest feed I've had in maybe ever. It was fantastic. I wish somebody told me. So, folks, if you have any other baby hacks at home, let me know. I could use them.
Yeah, in the active comments section down below, if you have a dad tip for Zach, or if you're watching and you feel like tweeting, you can use @DanburyHatTrick and use the hashtag ZachDadTip.
Appreciate that.
You can get some little advice.
Advice, and then I'll compile everything, give them to my wife, and she'll look at me and go, "What did you do?"
I think the number one advice for you in particular, I think, would just be get out of the way.
Yes.
Let Jen take the reins.
I get out of the way until I'm told to get in the way, and then I have to hold them, and then I got to burp them, and then I got to change them.
How are you at changing? How quick can you get it?
Oh, I'm fantastic.
Yeah?
Oh, yes.
And that's a point of pride, I know, for a young father.
Oh, absolutely. First of all, I always claimed that I was never going to change a diaper. Clearly, I knew this wasn't.
Yeah, that'll last.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It lasted about 2 hours into his life because he had to be changed, and the nurse says, "All right, Dad, here you go," and I go home.
Well, 2 hours after the birth, I'm thinking Jen deserves a rest, don't you think?
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. But there are,
you're the dad. You got to step up to the plate.
I'm busy taking care of my wife. She needs her head pets. She wanted ice chips. Have to get her ice chips.
Yeah, because no one else in that hospital can get her ice chips.
Nobody else knew where it was.
And you did?
Yes, I did my scouting mission. I knew how to get through the nurse's station to this little box.
That is a dad move.
Oh, absolutely. Little red button and suddenly, and then ice.
Have you ever heard Seth Meyers tell the story of how his kid was born?
No, I have not.
His most recent child, I don't think it's his first kid. It might be, though. I could be wrong. But his kid was born in the lobby of his apartment building.
No kidding.
So he didn't have ice chips. He didn't have nursing staff around him. But
it was a fire guard.
Exactly. It had a security guard and really just kind of people milling about in his apartment building. It was a viral clip that went live and a couple months ago, I want to say. But, so at least you had the comfort of being in your hospital.
Well, my wife went into labor the day of Thanksgiving. It was Thanksgiving night. Everything was set. This was beautiful. I drop her grandmother off at her house. I come back. I'm going to have my secondary food, the leftovers. I had Apollo 13 on because football was over. Everything was great. And then my wife walks into the room and goes, "Honey, I think we have to go." And off we go.
Apollo 13. My dad, my older brother was born on September 2nd, 1992.
Okay.
And on that date was Jimmy Connors playing at the U.S. Open.
Oh.
And it was a grudge match with, I believe, John McEnroe. And And it's going into the late sets, and, you know, as my dad is getting ready for my mom to head into labor, he's watching Jimmy Connors. It's a significant thing because it was Jimmy Connors' birthday on that day as well.
Did he get to watch the end of the match?
In a minute, honey. I understand my firstborn child is being born right now, but Jimmy's about to take the fifth set.
Yeah, listen, no, you have to have your priorities. You get a whole lifetime with the kid, but a game like that?
Yeah.
Or a match like that? I'm sorry.
It comes around once in a lifetime.
Once in a lifetime.
Well, against all odds, it would seem as though we are ready to play some hockey as the Danbury Hattricks are coming out onto the ice right now, as are the Danville Dashers. We're going to turn you around and get set. After that extensive layover, we appreciate your patience and your understanding and for continuing to tune in on Danbury Hattricks Hockey. As always, you can follow the Danbury Hattricks at Danbury Hattricks on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and YouTube. And you can subscribe to our YouTube channel for more live game streams like this one, as well as exclusive behind-the-scenes footage, interviews, highlights, and more, as well as our feed for tomorrow night's game, which will be scheduled at 7 o'clock, the pregame ceremony for the Danbury Trashers, Mad Hatters, Whalers, Titans, and, of course, Corey Fulton. That'll be getting underway at 7 o'clock with puck drop tentatively scheduled for 7:30. So 47 seconds remains in the man advantage for the Danbury Hattricks before Fred Hein, who took his penalty what feels like eons ago, is able to rejoin the action. The Hattricks will be starting out Carter Shinkara, Kendall Bullen-Porter, Shane Morrissey, Gordy Bunnell, and Aaron Atwell, mixing up the power play unit just a little bit. Hattricks will be skating from left to right on your YouTube screen, donning their traditional home blacks with orange and white trim. Danville with a very similar color scheme, wearing their whites with orange. That was, I remember distinctly, one of the first things that was commented on our game stream back on October 25th on opening night. It was fans noticing that we had the same color scheme as the Danville Dashers. Just as we were getting ready to start, we have another whistle on the faceoff.
The oranges are slightly different. A little bit more red in the Danville orange.
Correct.
Danville has, they've really taken ownership of the Philadelphia Flyers colors, whereas the Danbury Hattricks, they proudly wear the colors of the Diamond Group, the new owners of both the Danbury Arena, the Danbury Hattricks, the Danbury Colonials. And boy, you want to talk about an ownership group that has really turned things around. I cannot speak highly enough of Bill and Jim Diamond and what they've been able to do here in Danbury.
Puck is dropped and away we go for the third period. Aaron Atwell back in his own end. Chased by Neher over to Kendall Bullen-Porter. I feel like you have to get reacquainted with all of these names and faces. It feels like you haven't seen them in forever ago. It's like a college reunion.
That's the longest penalty I've ever heard of.
Carter Shinkarik motors in on the left wing. Off the end boards looking for Morrissey. It will instead be flipped out towards the blue line past Aaron Atwell. Quintos will give chase. Dylan Kelly aggressively skates into the corner. Now over to Bullen-Porter. Leaves it for Gordy Bunnell with 15 seconds to go on the power play. Out to the neutral zone, Bullen-Porter sends it in deep, touched up by Danville and sent down the length of the ice, and that will do it for the penalty as Dylan Kelly will settle it down. Atkins was lurking. Cruise List Mayor also in the neighborhood.
And that's the challenge, I think, with having not only a power play carry over into another period, but also having that long layoff too. Because you have to kind of readjust and say, hey, we have the man advantage. And it's interesting to see which team's going to benefit, which team's going to kind of suffer from the longer layoff. The first 3 or 4 minutes are going to be a clear sign of which team will benefit from it.
Whose legs are still alive? Nicola Levesque entering in, drops it back for Ruiz. Ruiz with a wrist shot, that's blockered aside by Gordachuk and goes up into the netting out of play.
Yeah, you were talking about the legs. Curiously, I don't think they put much, if any, water down on the ice. It looks mostly like a dry cut to me after they had the shovels out and everything else like that. So we'll see how the ice holds up during these 20 minutes of play. The passing, it might not be as smooth as we saw for the first 40 minutes.
Faceoff will be to the right of Gordachuk, and you are right, the ice conditions here at Danbury, they're normally pretty choppy as it is. It's about to get even choppier with the dry cut.
And again, let's see if strategy changes from that. We might see more dump and chase.
Bronner trying to shove it home on the far side post was met by a couple of defenders. Ruiz takes the puck away, has it on the circle. Down low to Bronner. Bronner looking for the sharp angle try save. Gordichuk, backhander is fought off and steered aside by Atkins.
Good chance by Bronner there. I like the decision to go, even though he's at a weird angle. Just put that on net. Make Gordichuk make the save and see if he can come away with anything.
Mealy brought down to the ice. That'll be a trip going against Danville, and Danbury will get a power play.
Oh, once again, we get to see Danbury with the man advantage. They're 1-for-2 so far. This is a great way to start off the period. You finish out the remainder of the penalty from last week or the second period, whatever you want to call it, and now you get a fresh 2 minutes to get back to work.
And it's Atkins again who's going to go for a trip, so he spent now up to 4 minutes in that penalty box, and you got to get your offense going for Danbury. I think the choppy ice, you mentioned that it might result in more dump and chases. That might benefit Danville a little bit better just based on how they've been playing the boards, but Danbury doing a good job right now. If they could stay with the man advantage, keep possession of the puck, they don't care about the ice condition whatsoever.
But now over to Atwell at the near side point. Maneuvers to his left, gets it down low. Quick passing out to Bunnell at the slot. Bunnell's shot save. A rebound try off the side of the net. Gordichuk sprawling on his back. Bunnell hesitated just a little bit to try to get the puck square on his forehand. Quick passing out to Dearson. Levesque setting a screen in front. That shot off a defensive stick of Ensor, and it goes up into the netting out of play. 1:17 to go in the power play.
When Dearson has that much open space in front of him, he either needs to take the shot immediately or he needs to move it faster. By taking his time on that, it allows the shooting lane to get blocked. It gets the puck goes out of play. Good opportunity for Danbury, but they don't get a shot on goal.
Faceoff will be to the right of Gordichuk as he takes a moment to take a swig of water.
This is smart. Buy some time here for yourself. Kind of let your defenders rest a little bit. And a little gamesmanship there for Gordichuk. It's a smart move.
I like that move as well because during that last sequence, he awkwardly went down to the ice. There was nobody in front of the net, so I'm not sure if he caught a rut, but it took him a few seconds to recover.
Shinkarik being harassed from behind by Efimov Barakov. Kasich being chased from behind by Efimov Barakov. It'll be taken and sent back in towards Dylan Kelly, who steers it aside. Minute to go in the power play. Shinkarik to Morrissey. Morrissey keeps his feet moving. Sends it up to Bronner. Just out of reach of him, it'll be taken away by Ensor. He'll retreat behind his own net. Pursued by both Kasich and Bronner, he'll kiss it off the glass and get it down the length of the ice.
And just no time in the zone for Danbury other than that initial try with Bunnell sitting in that slot area. That chance was really good. Other than that, relatively quiet. Danbury just can't handle passes in the neutral zone. Really nice job for Danville.
Down towards Zylak. 20 seconds to go. Zylak in shorthanded. Zylak throws a good check on Kasich and takes the puck away. Flips it out to the near side point. Evading a check, Murray looking to the far side corner. No one was home. That would be where someone would normally stand if they had five skaters.
Exactly, Casey. He made the right decision to pass into that corner. There's just nobody there because they're a man down.
Entering in is Morrissey, has Anderson and Dearson in front of the net. Power play is officially over. Taken away and carried up by Atkins. Atkins is near joining the rush. As Murray behind him finds him. Tied up and taken away and sent back out into the neutral zone.
A great breakup by Corey Anderson there. Danville entered the zone with numbers. Brown did a good job of steering Atkins to the outside, and it was Corey Anderson's hustle that finishes it off.
Over by the Hattricks bench, Atkins has Ensor with him. Atkins spins away from the check of Steve Mealy. Set up in front, Niehurst's shot gets turned aside by Kelly. Another try trickles towards Kelly, and he holds onto it. 4:25 gone by here in the third period.
You start to see Danville starting to gain some momentum in the offensive zone. Again, good cycle movement, and then they're trying that goal line pass up to somebody in the slot. It's worked a couple times. Kelly makes the sure save there, but you just see the passing, the cycle movements. It's all starting to come back together for Danville over the last couple of shifts.
One by the Dashers. Backhander is sent wide. Niehurst has Quintos with him as well as Koch. Pops up, Quintos trying to settle it down as Bullen Porter hampering him from behind. Bullen Porter keeping with Quintos. Great check by Bullen Porter. Brings him down to the ice. Puck retained by Danville. Nieher spins away from a checker. Now Johnny Ruiz marking him. Behind the net, looking. Taken away by Ruiz up the left wing wall. Pops up into the air. Bronner chops at it. Danville. Nieher has it stripped from behind. Koch entering in as Bullen Porter in front of him. Bullen Porter is all over the ice when he's in his defensive zone. We talked about how speed was his primary asset earlier in the broadcast, and boy, is he ever putting that on display here.
Yeah, he's been excellent tonight. I think his all-over game is strong, especially because Steve Brown, usually more of an immobile defenseman, likes to play the strong game.
Here's Shinkarik entering in right side. Shinkarik cutting to the net. Save. Gordachuk rebound bouncing around in front, trying to shove it home on the near side post. And covered up by Gordachuk, but a hooking call will be assessed against the Dashers.
That's the first time, I think, in this game that we've seen Carter Shinkarik really hit the Jets, because he was even with the Danville defender. I believe that it was Hawgood who was watching Shinkarik. And then Shinkarik, one, two, three strides, and he's right around him.
And that's the danger of this Hattricks team again. Danville spending so much time in the offensive zone. They get caught a little bit. And Shinkarik, all the speed in the world, he makes a smart move to cut back, draw the penalty, still get a dangerous shot on goal. Eventually gets shoved out. Gordachuk does well to stay with it. But a really nice move there by Shinkarik to take the penalty and go in here, and Danbury trying to add to their lead.
Carter Shinkarik saw a 12-game point streak come to an end down in Columbus, Georgia. And for Shinkarik, I'm sure he's a bit frustrated as he hasn't scored a goal in six games. Here's Mealy with a long shot saved by Gordachuk, and he holds. So that power move by Shinkarik, even though he does have a primary assist tonight, he is still contributing to the team's success. But I'm sure, if only just from a purely selfish point of view, you're getting some prime looks and you want to find the back of the net and convert.
Yeah, him and Morrissey have both been hungry. They've both been kind of stymied in their goal-scoring efforts, and they're really, really prolific in that category. Those two together on that line has been one of the best producing lines in the entire league over the last month or so. They were just silenced down in Georgia last week, and they want to get going big time.
1:20 to go on the power play, and you are right. Shane Morrissey went three games without a point. Shane Morrissey had not gone consecutive games without a point in his entire FPHL career. Here's Morrissey entering in now. Holds it in his near side circle. Bronner setting a screen. Out to Shinkarik at the point as Ruiz across the way. Off the end boards. Bronner looking for the stuff in. Gordachuk has his left leg glued down onto the ice and holds onto the puck. And Bronner engages with Troy Murray after the whistle.
I think this has been kind of building as Bronner's been doing some real work in front of a net. Gordachuk himself has taken a couple whacks at Bronner's ankles already.
Yeah, and Bronner just creating that space in front of the net. Finally, the Dashers are able to mark him. In the first couple of plays, Bronner was wide open in front of Gordachuk. It was just mano a mano. And finally, Troy comes over, and he tries to stymie him away. And you just see the play kind of develop after the whistle.
Set up in front looking for Anderson. Can't connect with him. Dearson keeps it in. Over to Levesque. Levesque over to Dearson as Atwell across the blue line. Bunnell in between the hash marks at the bumper position. Taken away by Danville, and Quintos carries it up as Nieher with him. Quintos trying to get around Dearson, forced wide. Hunched over trying to get the puck to himself. 30 seconds to go here in this power play. Now carried up with a little bit of speed is Anderson, 3-on-3. Anderson gets around a defender in behind, looking for the stuff in. Poked away by Gordachuk and cleared. 15 seconds to go in the man advantage. Kelly, long pass, finds Dearson. Dearson has Mealy and Kasich hopping over the bench boards. Mealy enters in, met by the defense. So that was Ensor knocking the puck off the stick. 2 seconds and one, that will do it for the power play. Here's Kasich behind the net with Mealy in front. Over for Dearson, sharp angle try, paddled aside by Gordachuk. Turner, checked by Kasich, leaves it for Ensor. over to the right wing and carried up now by Hawgood, fresh out of the box. 12 minutes remains in regulation time. The Hatricks lead 3-2. Dylan Kelly will hold onto the puck. Zylak was there pressuring him in front. And it'll be an offensive zone draw for the Dashers as they try to even up the score.
I think Danville needs to really put a precedent on staying out of the penalty box. Stay disciplined over these next couple of minutes here. They need to get sustained 5-on-5 opportunities because they've been successful with that, I think, in this period. What's really hurting them is just keep going back to the box and not being able to continue their rushes, continue their momentum.
And it really has sapped the first half of this period from them.
Bolin Porter sends it towards the front of the net, intercepted by the Dashers, and up the ice they come. Hein, joined by Neher. They have Murray on the left wing, looking for him, broken up by Brown, and from his knees is able to shuffle it up to Morrissey. Morrissey getting it ahead. Fancy move, trying to get around a man forced into the corner. He had Manocchio in front of him. Now here's Gullo with Brown in front of him. Gullo run off by Brown into the corner as he hugs him against the boards. Atkins gets it out to Hein, but no further. It will go out to the neutral zone. Turner will retreat. 11 minutes remains in regulation time. Airborne pass was batted down and dumped in now by Steve Mealy. Dashers looking for the breakout, carrying it up. Atkins dumps it in past the red line. Kelly behind his net to field. Zach Sheik seeing his first shift of the third period out there for the Hatricks, paired with Cruz Listmeyer. Dearson along the near side corner of his own wall. Dearson now looking to his left. Anderson enters in with him. Dearson keeping his feet moving, gets a shot off, save. Gornachuk, rebound, they score! A beauty of a move by Dearson, capped off by Mealy. And the Hatricks lead it 4-2.
Well, finally, Danbury gets the zone entry that they're looking for. Kasper Dearson dips to the shoulder, drives towards the front of the net. Gornachuk makes the initial save, and Steve Mealy following up on the play. Somehow it's only his fifth goal of the season, and boy, does that feel good for him.
And he was talking about how happy he was to be able to play at that center position. Dearson, Anderson, that line connects again. Dearson with a strong move to the net. He's been skating well in this game. He gets knocked off the puck just at the end. Gornachuk out of position, and Mealy hungry for the rebound, being able to stifle that in. Oh, Steve Mealy with a smile on his face as he walked in the building, excited for today's game. The price pays off and an ever-so-needed insurance goal for the Hatricks.
For Steve Mealy, it is his first goal since January 9th, so I'm sure it is a nice moment for him to finally get back into the goal column. As you mentioned, Jack, his fifth goal of the season, and the assist will be to Kasper Dearson, as Dearson with a beautiful power move to get through. That whole thing starts because no one really marked Dearson. Mm-hmm. When he picked up the puck in his own zone, he started carrying it ahead, and it's almost like Dearson was surprised at how much open space they were giving him.
Again, Danville's had a couple of moments where they just aren't quite prepared at Danbury's carrying the puck. I mean, there are lanes that are just wide open for Danbury to just carry on through. There's no resistance, and that's really how all four of these goals have started, was just space that's open there for Danbury. Nobody in a white uniform to step up and take on the man. And Dearson creates that opportunity where Mealy taps in.
Morrissey brought down to the ice. That'll be another call. But here comes Shinkarak looking to the net. Save in front. Yawning net mouth. Puck still loose. Touched up by Danville. What a play by Shane Morrissey to keep that play alive as he was dragged down to the ice. The Hatricks will get a power play.
That might be the prettiest stick handling I've seen in a very long time, and somehow it doesn't result in a goal. But Danville continues their parade to the penalty box. 9:04 remaining in the third period. I mean, if you're Danbury, this is fantastic, especially with that insurance goal.
Absolutely, and there's the speed again from the blue line. I sound like a broken record, but that's how Danbury is gaining these opportunities, taking all of these penalties, I should say drawing all these penalties. They're doing such a good job at beating guys in the puck.
Shorthanded rush, though. Here comes Neher in on Kelly. Neher looking to the net. He scores! A shorty by Jesse Neer and the Danville Dashers. Exact revenge, and it's back to a one-goal game.
Exactly. You want to get back into this game, you score a shorty like that. Great speed shown, and the power play unit, they'll find themselves on the bench because for once they were caught flat-footed. It nearly was a 2-on-0 going the other way.
And the only reason it wasn't a 2-on-0 is because the initial pass is slowed up after the fact. What a one-handed pass that was from the neutral zone. I believe that was Quintos.
We'll see who gets the official assist, but now we've got ourselves a brand new hockey game once again. 8:53 to go in the third period, and look out here.
Oh, now another shorthanded try, and they score! Mitch Atkins, a pair of shorthanded goals, and the Dashers even it up!
Well, Danbury falls asleep off the faceoff, kind of caught in between Atwell and Dearson, both kind of waiting for each other to go after the puck, and a man who spent plenty of time in the penalty box, Atkins just picks it right up and skates on in. Kelly has no chance at this one. Great release on the shot, and Danville, boy, have they woken up here in the last couple of seconds.
Was it 3 seconds that separated those two goals?
Well, I'll take a look at the official score sheet because it still hasn't even updated from the last shorthanded goal. And we're tied.
An unbelievable, stunning turn of events. As the Hattricks were looking like they had momentum, they get an insurance goal, they get a power play, and two shorthanded goals by Neher and Atkins. Oh boy, here comes Mealy now in with some work to do for Danbury. Mealy back to Boland Porter, to Atwell in the high slot, long shot, redirected, bouncing in front, it's loose. It pops out to the far side point. Boland Porter with 8:10 to go. Halfway through this power play, a disastrous power play for the Danbury Hattricks.
You see the move for Billy McCreary. Sticks Boland Porter out there on the blue line with Atwell. I know Boland Porter's truly a forward, but he's been playing defense all day today. He is not letting them get burned again at the blue line. Just complete collapse for the Danbury defense. Danville all over it.
Well, the Hattricks only have 4 men out there right now. I don't see a penalty on the board, though, and I don't see anyone in the box. Is that just a mistake?
It is. It is, and now
right
they're
now
down to three.
Morrissey and Kasich now hop over the boards. Now with some room is Gullo. Gullo with a backhander. That's a glove save by Kelly.
McCreary's got to take a timeout.
Absolutely. I was about to say the same thing. You got to take a timeout and get everybody focused again because this power play has been abysmal. There's still 28 seconds left on it. I wish we could just decline it and go back to even strength. I mean, just a lack of communication there, Casey. You mentioned it when there were 4 out there. At one point, there were only 3. Danbury Hattricks out on the ice, and they're on the power play.
The Hattricks just went about 10, 15 seconds down a man.
And it's not to say that this happens right after the long break in the second intermission either. I mean, this is after Danbury's able to score an extra insurance goal and have sustained time on power plays. They just fell apart.
At this point, that's in the rearview mirror,
yeah.
That long holdover. We're 7 minutes and 19 seconds away from the end of regulation time. 15 seconds remains in this power play.
And Casey, to answer your question before, officially 6 seconds between the shorthanded goals.
Certainly didn't feel that long.
No, it didn't, but that's what the score sheet says.
Well, I'm reminded of the Washington Capitals who scored 2 goals in 2 seconds officially.
That's the fastest, fastest in NHL history.
That is correct. It wasn't quite that quick, but it certainly felt like it as Gordychuk backhand gloves it and will hold as we're back to even strength. Perhaps mercifully if you're on the Danbury Hattricks bench.
Now 6:52 remaining. Normally this is where the media timeout would pop in, but perhaps in lieu of the delay, or no. Referees finally notice it, and teams will head back to their benches.
Well, as the teams are heading back to their benches, let's take a look around the league for the FPHL out-of-town scoreboard. We already know that at the end of 2 periods in the NWHL, it is a 4-2 Whale lead.
Oh,
so the Whale 20 minutes away from a playoff win.
Let's go, Whale. The Danbury Colonials out in Long Beach tonight. They're up 6-2 in the third period down in NA3HL action. around the rest of the Federal Hockey League? Well, Elmira from the 5-yard line, they ran it in. They defeat the Mentor Icebreakers by a 10-3 score as things go from bad to worse out in Ohio. The Watertown Wolves, they drop a 6-4 decision at home to the Port Huron Prowlers. Alex Hapitchin with the game-winning goal, only a minute 12 left in regulation time. Meanwhile, out in Serial City, USA, the Delaware Thunder, they kick the extra point, 7-1 your final over the Battle Creek Rumblebees. And going into, at last look, going into a shootout, and now it's gone final, the Columbus River Dragons, a shootout victory over the Carolina Thunderbirds.
Wow, a big win for the River Dragons as they try to get catch up to the these same Danville Dashers. There's still a little bit of time left.
Well, after taking 2 of 3 from the first place team in the Eastern Division, they're feeling it now.
Yeah, Columbus trails now by 9 points, the Danville Dashers.
And it puts a lot of pressure on Danville because Port Huron wins on top of them, below them. Obviously, Columbus gets the victory over what's looked like the division winners this season in Carolina. So a lot of pressure here in this game now for Danville if they want to hold that third spot right now.
Danville right now feeling a bit of momentum as within the span of 6 seconds they came into a tie now for the second most shorthanded goals in the league with 13 as a team. We knew their penalty kill unit was good. They came in at 85.1% efficiency. We didn't know it would be that offensively potent.
And that's the thing, a pair of goals, that hurts enough, but doing it shorthanded?
Anderson with a shot redirected into the corner. That's the cardinal sin when you're on the power play. There are two things you can never do on a power play. That's ice the puck and put the puck in your own net. Carrying it in now is Brawson. Knocked off the puck by Atwell. Dearson brought down, ridden into the boards, comes up a bit shaken. Anderson dumps it in deep. Bunnell will give chase. Bunnell ridden into the boards. Plays it towards the net. Gordachuk steers it aside. Behind the net. Here's Hawgood. Looking to escape. Punched out of the air by Hine, but kept in by Bunnell. He takes a stick to the face, comes up holding his chin. Play goes on.
Yeah, Zylak
together with Zylak, and he comes driving Zylak's head into the ice. That's a dangerous play. And Zylak comes up wanting retribution for Bunnell. And Bunnell will skate back to his bench.
And Bunnell's going to go see the trainer for some repairs. And, yeah, going after Zylak, I like it. You want to defend yourself, but not in that fashion.
He went driving down. He landed on top of the back of his head. That's a dangerous play. 4:30 to go in regulation time. Here's Steve Brown. Levesque in behind the end line. That will be an icing call. And we'll come back down towards the Danbury hat trick zone.
And guys, before the whole altercation with Bunnell at center ice, he actually does a really good job on the forecheck, grinding hard. He's the only hat trick in the Danville zone. He's working hard trying to get the puck loose. It all starts from a good play from Corey Anderson, who just dumps it in, sees that they're outmatched as they carry it into the blue line. A much smarter decision by Corey Anderson. Instead of just trying to skate into bodies, they dump in and get some good sequence.
Shot off the faceoff held by Kelly. We'll do it again.
Well, Danville has really controlled this game seemingly for the last 2 hours, so basically since the 10-minute mark of the second period. They're out shooting Danbury by a 33 now to 31 margin as Danbury suddenly had another shot on goal get added. But again, Danville, two shorthanded goals. I'm still on this.
Kasich with a 2-on-1 developing. He's got Morrissey. Kasich looking to the net, blocked in front by Turner. Switching places. Here's Kasich. Leaves it back for Mealy. 4 minutes to go in regulation. Mealy with Bull and Porter in the high slot. Listmayer along the wall. Listmayer pitches it down low for Morrissey as Kasich behind the end line with him. Looking out in front, intercepted by Hine. Skied up into the air, and back to retrieve will be Listmayer. Long pass intended for Shinkarik. Will go out of his reach, and another icing. 3:44 to go in regulation time.
Yeah, he doesn't have to make that pass. Listmayer just fires that thing in. And he's got so much open space, he could skate a little bit and then pick a softer, shorter pass. Instead, he goes for the home run bomb, and it just goes past everyone and down for another icing.
And Carter Shinkarik has good hand-eye coordination, but nothing he can do on that.
Bolin Porter pursued from behind by Nieher. Collides with his own man in Listmayer, and oh boy, that opens up a little bit of space. There's Quintos looking down low for Nieher. Nieher ridden into the boards, and that is a vicious hit by Listmayer, and that will be a penalty. Touched up by Shinkarik, and Listmayer will go. Listmayer gave Nieher a case of whiplash there with that hit along the wall.
He's a physical player, just a little too physical on that one. Good to see Nieher okay. Coming up, doesn't look fazed by that hit, but this is a crucial point in this game. Cruz Listmayer takes a penalty in his own end, and you have to say this is where Danville, they must be licking their chops right now. They just had the two quick shorthanded goals. They have the momentum in this game. 3:24 in regulation. Jump on this opportunity here. Try to expose Danbury and see if they can beat Dylan Kelly.
Oh, Danville's 0-for-1 on the power play so far, but how nice would it be for their special teams to take the lead once again?
Quintos sends it down low. Brosson shoulder save Kelly. Quintos is out there with Atkins, Fred Hine, Brosson, and Turner. Countering for the Hattricks is Mealy, Bunnell, Atwell, and Brown. Speeding ahead is Quintos. Stops short, drop pass intended for Hine. Bunnell throws a check on Turner. Mealy turns around and sends it down the length of the ice.
Guys, I don't know about you, but this building has been awfully quiet over the last 3 or 4 minutes. There's not much to be excited about right now, and obviously the two quick goals take the life out of the building. The long delay doesn't help as well, and now, I mean, it is just silent in here.
Intercepted, long slap shot off the end boards. Good play there by Troy Murray to keep it in. Nieher comes tumbling down to the ice, as does Atwell. Hard check by Bronner. Zylak back to his feet as Shinkarik will shovel it out of the zone and clear.
Oh, Shinkarik gets his stick down just in a nick of time as sneaking in from the blue line, I believe it was Seth Ensor, and boy, he would have had nothing but open ice and a nice 4x6 in front of him.
Ensor will try to play it ahead as he collides with Dearson. Dearson trying to lift the stick. Over to Koch in the corner. Taken away, high slot, winding, firing, slap shot wide. Ensor has a man down low in Zylak. Looking out to the high slot, Koch taking a shot, saved by Kelly, rebound bouncing around between the hash marks, out to the blue line, kept in by Ensor. 15 seconds to go on the power play. Taken by Mealy, he takes a stick to the midsection. Looking for a call, will not get it, will be forced out in the neutral zone. Koch takes it away as Zylak streaking to the net. Zylak shot, glove saved by Kelly! And he holds with 5 seconds remaining in the power play.
Well, Zylak tries hurtling over the net as he knocks it off of its moorings, but Dylan Kelly coming up big when his team needs him to, as he's not able to see these shots from the point. They're pinballing their way on in, and somehow he's able to get his pads on him.
Yeah, a couple of good, strong saves, and it's actually Danville wanted a couple of calls. Danbury got away with a slash right in front of their goaltender, and the entire Danville bench was up, standing up with their arm in the air, wanting that call. They didn't get it. Danbury, oof. Holding their breath right now, and it's Dylan and Kelly keeping the team above water.
Quintos will remain out there with Atkins, as well as Artem Efimov-Barakov, who we haven't seen much of here in the third period on the forward lines. Waning seconds of the power play. Brown gets to it. That'll do it for the man advantage. Cruz Listmayer back out of the box. Will make his way towards the bench. He'll be replaced by Gordy Bunnell. Holding on to it is Dmitry Danilik. Off the glass and out by Steve Brown. 1:10 to go in regulation time. If we do not have a goal in the next minute and 10 seconds, there will be overtime. Streaking in is Quintos behind the defense, barreling into Kelly, and Kelly turns it aside. And there will be a delayed call as a result, as yes, indeed, Quintos had a stick all tied up in his midsection. And for the final 56.4 seconds of regulation time, the Hattricks will be shorthanded, and a brutal 10-minute stretch gets even worse.
And they're just stuck in the mud right now, not being able to move their feet. Danville just that much quicker. And they're just playing flat right now, Danbury is. And Danville's all over it. They're going to call a timeout here and get things all set up here for the remainder of this period. It's all dashers right now. And It's going to have to be Dylan Kelly to stand on his head here to try to secure this thing and push it. I mean, the thing that Danbury needs right now is just to get this thing to overtime, because they haven't had any success really on the penalty kill in the offensive zone. They haven't had the chances, and just the way that they're playing right now, they need some sort of spark. Getting to the overtime period is what they have to need to move forward in this game.
You know what struck me is I'm seeing Danbury being out-physicaled mm-hmm. right now. It's very rare where the Hattricks get pushed around the way they are right now.
Well, with 56.4 seconds remaining on the clock, you could see Billy McCreary speaking with his player assistant coach Nicola Levesque and veteran presence Phil Bronner as they try to draw up a defensive zone play. It'll be Bronner out there with Kendall Bolin Porter and Aaron Atwell, joined by Carter Shinkarik. For the Danville Dashers, it will be Fred Hine out with Quintos and Atkins. Brawson and Turner will complete the five-man power play unit.
Look for Brawson. He had a nice open one-timer in the far side circle earlier in the previous power play. Look for him again.
Quintos has it. Brawson setting up at that far side circle. Quintos, open space in front of him, maneuvers to the circle. Backhand shot save, Kelly. Rebound steered out by Atwell, kept in by Turner. Over to Hine. Hine looking for the slot, bouncing around. Kelly springs on the puck. And Atwell clears the crease after the fact and gets an appreciative tap on the backside from his netminder.
Well, Mitch Atkins looking to get the hat trick any way he can. He doesn't even get his stick on this pass. Instead, he just directs it with his skate on goal. Dylan Kelly pads down on the ice, keeps it out, and then Aaron Atwell sends Atkins away.
Same units out for the Danville Dashers. Steve Mealy out with Kendall Bolin Porter, Gordy Bunnell, and Aaron Atwell. Rawson, backdoor pass, they score! Pinpoint passing to Mitch Atkins, and the Danville Dashers, with 31.7 seconds remaining in regulation time, have reclaimed the lead.
Well, once again, Dylan Kelly gets hung out to dry as there are two players down low for Danville on either side of the net. And, you know, I believe it was Ethan Bush Anderson who was out. Or, no, it was Kendall Bolin Porter.
Yes.
He took the near side guy, but it left the far side guy wide open. And, again, there's nothing Dylan Kelly can do in a situation like that.
Well, a timeout now will be taken by Billy McCreary. And if you're Billy McCreary, you have to be sensing a little bit of a sense of desperation.
Oh, certainly. I imagine Dylan Kelly will begin between the hash mm-hmm. marks, and as soon as Danbury has possession, he'll come to the bench for the extra attacker, and we'll see who gets called out there. Casper Dearson, his game has settled down so far. He's gotten better as the game's gone along. Shane Morrissey and Carter Shinkarik, two great candidates. Corey Anderson, he's got two goals in this game.
Yeah, I mean, he has to choose smartly here. And again, Danbury just needed to get through 56 seconds, and they couldn't even get through 25. It was just a pinpoint pass. Again, Brawson just that head up right there, and I just can't believe how wide open Mitch Atkins was. That is one of the more easier goals he'll ever score in his career. That is an absolute tap-in, 6 inches from the cup. You just tap it in for birdie, and Danbury, they lost this one big time. What a comeback for the Dashers. Down but never out. Great momentum, and they've actually stolen one here from Danbury.
Intercepted by Atkins, plays it down towards Kelly. Kelly keeps it alive to Bolin Porter. Kelly doesn't have time to vacate his net. Now Morrissey. Kelly to the bench. Morrissey to Levesque. Shot saved by Gordychuk. Rebound blocked in front. 5 seconds to go. And that will do it. The Danville Dashers stun the Danbury Hattricks on home ice. They score a pair of shorties in 6 seconds to even up the score. And the game-tying and game-winning goals come off the stick of Mitch Atkins. And the Dashers come away with a 5-4 victory. And for the first time since November, the Danbury Hattricks have lost the control of the Eastern Division. The Elmira Enforcers have officially passed them in the standings, and the Hattricks will need to regroup and come back with a more what can you even come back with tomorrow? Because it was such a turn in the late third period. Danville capitalized on every opportunity they were given.
Danbury, tomorrow, they need to be more physical. Mm-hmm. Quite simply, they were pushed around tonight, and Danville pushed them. I mean, give all the credit to the Dashers. A pair of shorties in 6 seconds. They get the game-winning goal on a power play with under a minute to go. I mean, what a comeback by the Dashers.
Unbelievable.
Oh, fantastic. I mean, that's a statement win for the Danville Dashers. They can look at, you know, as they go into the playoffs, whatever situation they're in, all they have to say in the room is, remember when we were in Danbury? Mm-hmm. We were down by two halfway through the third period. We came back and we won it in overtime or in regulation. We can do it here as well. Meanwhile, for Danbury, I mean, between the going one for out of three down in Columbus last weekend and now this, that's a gut check chime, because that is not the Danbury Hattricks way. That's not the way the Hattricks have, you know, gotten to first place in the first place.
Absolutely. Danville, I mean, they answered the call when they needed to tonight. And you look at that Western Division now, obviously Columbus gets the huge victory over the division leader in Carolina. Both Port Huron and Danville get victories. There is so much to be played for in that Western Division. It's so competitive between those four teams that are going to make the playoffs this year. That is going to be an exciting couple of series to watch. And if Danville can compete like this in a playoff atmosphere, they are going to be a tough out. And you're right, Zach. Danbury, this is a huge question mark for them, because they've dropped three out of the last four. Again, haven't strung together more than three losses this season. Tomorrow would be three in a row. They have to come out. They have to play intense hockey for a good 60 minutes. They took themselves out of the game way too quickly in that third period, and Danville was all over it. They took advantage when they needed to, and they made Danbury pay for some mistakes. That's how you close out a hockey game. If you're Danville, you're happy with the way you played tonight. You have to come back out tomorrow with the same mentality. Let's play spoiler night on Danbury alumni night. The Hattricks have to have a much better showing, especially the company in the crowd.
Any chance we can get Corey Fulton dressed for tomorrow?
Well, the Danbury Hattricks, as you mentioned, will be hosting their Danbury Alumni Night tomorrow night. Pre-game festivities will start at 7 o'clock as we honor the 06 Eastern Division UHL champs, Danbury Trashers, the 2008-2009 Danbury Mad Hatters, the 2013 Commissioner's Cup champion Danbury Whalers, and the 2016 regular season champion Danbury Titans, as well as Danbury Whalers legend Corey Fulton. You can tune in live on Danbury Hattricks' YouTube channel for exclusive live coverage of that game. That will do it here from Danbury Arena. In a somber conclusion to tonight's events. For Jack O'Mara and Zach McGinnis, I'm Casey Bryant, thanking everyone for tuning in and thanking everyone who makes a Danbury Hattrick game possible. Have a good night.
So...